Hi, good morning, everybody. Welcome to day one of the CUPA conference. We're here to have a fabulous UST time. I read the description of the course, and it looks like it's going to be wonderful and exciting, so we'll try and live up to that. I am Greg Breshears with Santa Clara County CUPA. I'm a senior hazardous material specialist. Been doing underground tanks for a while, so hopefully can answer at least any questions the beginner's class will throw at me. Want to keep a couple things in mind that this class is a one-third of a three-class series that's being presented by the CUPA Forum. So the CUPA Forum Board developed a training setup, and they've broken the underground storage tank training into beginner, intermediate, and advanced classes. So we're going to try and give you a really good overview of the regulations and an introduction to probably about 90% of the things that you need to know to inspect a typical underground storage tank. But this is not going to be everything that you need to know to inspect underground storage tanks. We're not going to be going into the more advanced, the current modern generation of tanks known as the VPH or vacuum pressure hydrostatic monitored tanks. We're going to touch on that just a little bit so that you know what you're seeing if you see it. But those issues are going to be addressed in later classes in the series. So there's an intermediate class that's going to be given by John Elkins of Sacramento County, and that's the afternoon session in this same room today. So if there's anything that we don't cover, hopefully it will be covered by John either in the intermediate class or the advanced class, which I believe is being offered Wednesday morning. So John's also giving the advanced class Wednesday morning. And there are a couple other classes that if you're interested in construction of tank systems, closure of tank systems, things like that, changes to regulations, really tricky things, there are sessions that are being provided by the State Water Board and other CUPA inspectors at this conference that can probably answer those things. So we're going to try and stay limited within the scope of the relatively beginner types of issues. This is definitely not extensive enough to take this course and think, or even this series of three courses, and think you can go out and pass the ICC exam, the International Code Council exam, to be a certified California UST inspector. But we hope it will be a good introduction for you and will give you a foundation that you can build upon to go on and eventually be able to inspect the most advanced systems that are out there. So the objectives of the class that are set out by the CUPA Forum Board are to give the new UST inspector with familiarity with the components and layout of a typical underground storage tank system. And
it's not changing
there. Oh.
Sorry. There we go.
Okay, there we go. Sorry, I guess I better look at the screen occasionally. So to give the beginning inspector with familiarity with the components and layout of a typical underground storage tank system, an understanding of the general provisions of California underground storage tank law and regulations, and this is a good point to place to point out that there are other regulations that do apply to underground storage tank systems that we're not going to be talking about. Fire code regulates underground storage tank systems, and a number of other codes do. Also federal law and regulations, but we're going to limit the scope of our discussion today to California underground storage tank statute, which is law, and regulations. So we want to get an understanding of new and existing underground storage tank system design, construction, and monitoring requirements. Again, for the newest systems, we're only going to touch on that very briefly. An understanding of the principles of tank, sump, and line testing and the requirements for reporting the test results. And an understanding of release recording and reporting requirements. And finally, a very brief intro to familiarity with and ability to assist underground storage tank operators with the completion of UST forms. And I put that in quotes because everything's gone paperless now with electronic submittal. So a couple features of the presentation that you'll hopefully find useful are we've given you code citations throughout. So anywhere where we're saying that something is a requirement, you will find a code citation and you can go in and look up that actual regulation. That said, for space reasons, we couldn't have every single wording of the regulations up here because it'd be way too dense of a slide. So we paraphrase things and whittle things down a little bit. So don't think that this is the go-to reference as far as regulatory requirements. You actually need to read the codes. You need to read the regulations and the statute before you start going out and writing people up for violations. And we've provided photographs to provide a visual reference and some diagrams that will hopefully help make these things seem a little bit, make a little bit more sense if you're totally new to underground storage tanks. So a few words of advice to the new inspector is to get familiar with the laws and regulations. For example, the way it's organized, you know, in Title 23 California Code of Regulations, which is where you'll find the underground storage tank regulations, Article 3 pertains to new tanks, and Article 4 pertains to existing tanks. You can't apply both sets of rules. It's going to be one or the other. So for any underground storage tank, you have to first of all figure out, okay, what kind of tank system is this? When did it go in? What set of rules do I apply to it? Because you don't get to apply a little bit from here and a little bit from there. You have to figure out what the correct set of rules is and apply that and only that set of rules to that underground tank system. So always, always, always find out when the UST system was installed. That is one of the most important things that you need to determine before you go out to do an inspect an underground storage tank system, because the set of rules that applies is based on when that system was installed. And the best place to find that is if your agency oversaw the installation of that, is to go in and actually look at the construction stuff, the inspection reports, plan check documents, and look for the inspection report that documented the date that the tank was set in the excavation. That means the date that it was put in the hole. That is considered to be the installation date for that tank. If you don't have records on that, then you can look at the data that was submitted on the California Environmental Reporting System, the CERS website, or your local electronic reporting portal if you have one. Or you can look at older paper copies for the old, what they called the Forms B, which is the Underground Storage Tank Operating Permit Application, the tank information page, which has a tank installation date on that. So hopefully somewhere in all of those sources you can find out when the tank was installed, because that determines whether it's a new tank or an existing tank and how it needs to be regulated. So a little bit of background, why are we doing this? Well, it's to protect the waters of the state. In California, at least in Santa Clara Valley, where we come from, pretty much all groundwater is drinking water. So if that fuel or whatever product it is that's in that underground storage tank does not stay in that system and gets out, it's going to potentially get into the drinking water, and we definitely don't want that. It was drinking water contamination that started the whole underground storage tank system a few decades back when he started having solvent leaks in Silicon Valley. So that was where this all came from. So we need to make sure that we're not letting the nasty stuff get outside. It's got to stay inside the tank system. So, laws and regulations. Again, we're only going to talk about California. Law, also known as statute. The underground storage tank statutes are published in the California Health and Safety Code. And the underground storage tank regulations are in Chapter 6.7. And then there's a little bit more information in Chapter 6.75, which is the Petroleum Underground Storage Tank Financial Responsibility Law. Some statutory requirements stand on their own. They'll write the law. It's pretty clear, hopefully, and they don't need to provide any additional explanation for it. But in cases where further study or greater detail is needed, the law will direct a state agency to undertake studies or to write regulations that provide more specific guidance on the requirements. So in California, the state agency that's responsible for implementation of the underground storage tank program is the State Water Resources Control Board, which we've indicated as SWRCB throughout the presentation. But when you look at it in the statute and regulations, it's just going to say the board. Anywhere where it says the board, in the context of underground storage tanks, they're talking about the State Water Board. California underground tank regulations are published in Title 23, Division 3 of the California Code of Regulations. So we're going to call that 23 CCR throughout the presentation. If there's something from another title, for example, Title 27, it's going to say 27 CCR, but pretty standard reference that that we've used. Chapter 16 is the underground storage tank regulations, which is a majority of what we're going to talk about. And Chapter 18 is the Petroleum Underground Storage Tank Cleanup Fund Regulations, which I'll explain in a little bit. So when you're looking at Title 23, it's a fair number of pages. There's a lot of information in there, but it has a table of contents at the beginning. So the most important thing is not to memorize every comma and every period that's in the regulations. The most important thing is to know where to find it. So we're not going to go through this slide in any detail, but this is how the regulations are laid out in the table of contents. So you'll see, as I mentioned earlier, so Article 3 is a new underground tank design, construction, and monitoring requirements. Article 4, the existing tank monitoring. If you want to go for closure requirements, it's Article 7, and so on. But know which article to find things in. This will be especially useful when you take your ICC inspector exam. Because it is open book, but you don't get to take your tabbed or highlighted copy in. So know where to find the requirements. That's a very important thing. You don't have to memorize every single thing, but you should memorize as much as possible. So laws versus regulation. It doesn't happen a whole lot, but every once in a while, the wording of law and the wording of regulations will conflict with each other. If that happens, law always trumps regulation. Law outranks regulation. So the requirements of the law would prevail if there is a conflict between the two. Unified program agencies are UPAs, which I think most of us who aren't industry members are inspectors for. We may enforce additional local requirements, but, and this is really an important point, it's only so long as they're truly legal requirements, such as county ordinance codes, municipal codes, fire code amendments, and as long as they don't conflict with state law or state regulation. You have to actually have a code or an ordinance behind what you're telling people they have to do. Agency policies are not enforceable. It's not sufficient just to go out and say, it's like, well, we want you to do this, and you need to do it because. You actually have to have a law or an ordinance behind it. Guidance documents can be used to clarify requirements or to communicate interpretations of regulatory gray areas or particularly complex areas, but they themselves are not laws or regulations. But the State Water Resources Control Board does have a lot of very useful references on their website. Those are called local guidance letters or LG letters. There's a lot of really useful information. We've given you a list towards the end of this presentation of some of the more critical ones that you should really familiarize yourself with. But a great source of information in the LG letters, and I've included the URL on the slide. By the way, all these slides are on the conference website, so anything we're going to talk about, you should be able to find. You don't need to take a huge amount of notes. So let's talk about a few definitions. What the heck is a tank? Well, a tank means a stationary device that's designed to contain an accumulation of hazardous substances, which is constructed primarily of non-earthen materials, including but not limited to wood, concrete, steel, or plastic, that provides structural support. You might think wood. Well, actually, we did run into fairly recently a redwood tank with oil in it that had been abandoned and required closure. So it was not obviously a compliant system that was in operation, but it was a system, it was an underground tank that was regulated and subject to the underground storage tank regulations for closure. Pipe means any pipeline or system of pipelines that's used in connection with the storage of hazardous substances and that is not intended to transport hazardous substances in interstate or intrastate commerce or to transfer hazardous materials in bulk to or from a marine vessel. So as long as you're not unloading a ship and as long as you're not doing bulk transfers between the states or within the state of hazardous substances, it's a pipe. Notwithstanding that section, that definition, pipe means a few other things. It means all parts of any pipeline or system of pipelines that's used in connection with the storage of hazardous substances, including, but not limited to, valves and other appurtenances connected to the pipe, pumping units, fabricated assemblies associated with pumping units, and metering and delivering stations and fabricated assemblies therein. So the definition of pipe is much broader than you might think at first. For tanks that are installed on or after July 1st of 2003, and this is the first example where we see the importance of figuring out exactly when that tank went in the hole, because this only applies to those tanks. Those portions of vent lines, vapor recovery lines, and fill pipes that are beneath the surface of the ground are considered pipe, as the term is defined in the underground storage tank statute. And therefore, they are a regulated part of the underground storage tank system. For tanks that were installed before July 1st, 2003, vent lines, vapor recovery lines, and fill pipes that are designed to prevent and do not hold standing fluid in the pipes or lines are excluded from the definition of underground storage tank. So that's a critical date to figure out whether these types of piping are regulated pipes or not regulated pipes under the California regulations. Pipe does not include unburied delivery hoses, vapor recovery hoses, and nozzles that are subject to unobstructed visual inspection for leakage. So if you're doing a gas station, you see the outside of the dispenser pump, what people commonly call the pump, not necessarily a pump, but that dispenser, all of that hanging hardware that's on there is regulated. It's regulated by fire code, it's regulated by CARB for air emissions, but it's not regulated as part of the underground storage tank system by anything that we enforce under the Unified Program Regulations. It's not regulated by the UST regulations or statute. So we talked about what a tank is. So what is an underground storage tank, or UST? Well, that means one or a combination of tanks, including pipes connected thereto. This is an important concept because the tank is defined as the tank and the pipes that are connected thereto. That is used for the storage of hazardous substances and that is substantially or totally beneath the surface of the ground. Well, what does that mean? Substantially beneath the surface of the ground means that at least 10% of the UST system volume, including the volume of any connected piping, is below the surface or enclosed below earthen materials. So there are situations where you could come across a tank system where you say, oh, that's obviously an above ground tank. It might be a small above ground tank. And it has a pipe that goes down under the ground. If that pipe is a decent diameter or if it runs for a really long distance, you may have 10% or more of your total volume under the surface of the ground, which would make that tank system subject to the underground storage tank regulations. So it's not always a no-brainer if they have an above-ground tank, what you would call an above-ground tank, that has buried piping. So we talked about what underground storage tank means. So what does underground storage tank system mean? Because that's also something that comes up in the regulations. So that means a underground storage tank, which was the tank and piping that's connected to it. So connected piping, ancillary equipment, and containment system, if any. So that pretty much captures most of the rest of the stuff that doesn't specifically get excluded or exempted somewhere else in the statute or regulations. Couple of really important concepts, and this falls into the you need to know when it went in the ground scenario again. So an existing underground storage tank means an underground storage tank that was installed prior to January 1st of 1984. You might think that, an existing tank is any tank that's in the ground before today. No, it's only those tanks under the statute and regulations that are considered existing tanks. And this is one of my favorite definitions in regulations. It says, a new UST means a UST that's not an existing UST. What could be more straightforward than that? You only have to know one definition. So, and again, I put down here in the note that the date installed is the date that the tank is set in the excavation during installation. So they put that tank in the hole. It may take them a year or two to finish plumbing and doing all the other hookup stuff that they need to do, and it may get finaled way after they put it in the hole. But the date that it goes in the hole is considered to be the installation date. That would apply as far as which set of rules are applicable for the tank system. Motor vehicle fuel tank, that's another term that will come up a few times in the regulation. And it's one that's not necessarily intuitive because you might think a motor vehicle fuel tank is limited to a tank that fuels a car or a truck or something like that, or maybe an airplane or who knows, a railroad locomotive. But that basically just means an underground storage tank that contains a petroleum product. So that's very broad. It could be a system that supplies a standby generator. It could be a system that supplies a boiler system or whatever. But from a regulatory standpoint, if it contains a petroleum product, that is a motor vehicle fuel tank. And petroleum is another pretty broad term that's not just gasoline and diesel, but it's other things like kerosene, some of the biodiesel blends other than B20, even E85, because it has 15% petroleum, is considered a petroleum blend. So, but one important thing to note is that the definition of motor vehicle fuel tank does not include an underground storage tank that contains used oil. So even though used oil, if it's petroleum used oil, is a petroleum material, it's not included within the definition of motor vehicle fuel tank. So a few acronyms and odds and ends that we'll use throughout the presentation. Annular space is a space between the primary and secondary containment. If you're going to have a double wall system, it's going to have an inner and it's going to have an outer containment. The annular space or interstitial space just means the space between those two walls. ATG means automatic tank gauge. Board, we talked about, means the state water board. CSLB, contractor state license board. DW, double wall component or system. CITLD is continuous in-tank leak detection. ELLD is electronic line leak detector. GPH, gallons per hour. ICC, I talked about, is the International Code Council. LLD is line leak detector, of which the ELLD is a subset. MLD, another subset, mechanical line leak detector, just two different technologies for the same type of device. PSI is pounds per square inch. STP means submersible turbine pump. SW is single wall, UDC, under dispenser containment, and finally VPH, vacuum pressure or hydrostatic, which refers to a monitoring type for the most advanced generation of tanks. And again, we're only going to just briefly touch on this. So, inspection frequency. Well, unified program agencies have to inspect every underground storage tank system within their jurisdiction at least once every year. That's in law. We have to do that. We have to be out there. What's the purpose of that inspection? Well, the purpose, and this is defined in Health and Safety Code, which is the law, not anybody's opinion, it's the law, says the purpose of the inspection is to determine whether the UST system complies with the California statute and the California underground storage tank regulations, including the design and construction standards that are applicable, and whether the UST owner has operator has monitored and tested the UST system as required by the permit, and whether the UST system is in a safe operating condition. So at a minimum, we need to be looking at those things when we've got to do these annual inspections. Keys to a successful inspection are know the code, critical. You have to know the code, what to apply to what system. Know the equipment, and this is one area that's pretty unique to underground storage tank inspections because you have all this leak detection equipment and containment systems and things like that. And to the newbie inspector, it can be really overwhelming with the variety of things that you'll find. So you need to try and learn as much as you can about the different types of equipment, what their limitations are, what their capabilities are, what the manufacturer requires in the way of maintenance and testing, what the manufacturer requires in the way of certifications and training for a technician to test and certify that. There's some information that's available on the internet, but on the manufacturer's websites, but this conference is a great opportunity to stop by the vendor booths that are going to be set up in a couple of days and actually talk to the people that manufacture and sell these systems. For a lot of the systems, they'll have examples of sensors and things that are just sitting on a table. And you can pick them up, handle them, look at them, see what they actually look like, and ask questions. Because this conference is a great resource for learning about those systems and how they're supposed to be operated. You can't always trust what you're told in the field when people tell you how it's supposed to be operated or how it's supposed to be installed or tested. Because some people do operate under misperceptions of what is required. So having firsthand information is very valuable. You need to thoroughly prepare for the inspection. Review the files, review the SIR submittals, look at previous inspection reports. Just make sure that you have a feeling before you go out there what kind of system you're going to be encountering or systems, because in some cases you'll find more than one generation of tank at a particular facility. But that tells you which regulatory hat to put on. Do I need to put on my existing underground tank hat? Do I need to put on my new underground tank hat? Or do I have to wear two hats at once? But again, never apply one set of rules, or two sets of rules to one tank. Two sets of rules could apply to a facility, but not to any one tank system. And then follow up. It's really important to follow up to make sure that you get to return to compliance documentation or you do a follow-up inspection to make sure that things are corrected if they had violations, to get things closed out so that when you go out next year to do the annual inspection, you don't find the same old things that haven't been addressed. So I just put a note on it. The installation records are the best place to find the installation date. Check SIRS, our historical tank information pages. Again, if you can't find it on SIRS. So what gives us authority to inspect these facilities? Well, if you've done any hazardous waste generator inspections, the authority is very similar to that for a hazardous waste inspector. In fact, the requirements are substantially incorporated by reference in the underground storage tank regulations, except they switch out the word for hazardous waste facility for the words for underground storage tanks, facilities and tank systems. But basically, we have the authority to respect, the authority with respect to any place where UST systems are located or in which records relevant to operation of UST are kept, to, at any reasonable hour of the day, enter and inspect the facility, review and copy any records, reports, test results, or other information required to verify compliance, and to photograph conditions constituting a violation. We can require the UST owner or operator to, upon request, submit any information relevant to compliance, to conduct monitoring or testing, and to report the results of that monitoring or testing under penalty of perjury. The authority conferred to the UPA includes the authority to conduct any monitoring or testing of a UST system. So, in other words, if we have reasonable cause to think that they're not properly monitoring or testing a tank system, we can monitor or test it. That would be at our expense, but if it resulted in an enforcement case, we could pursue cost recovery to get that money back. Really important to always be reasonable. Don't show up 5 minutes before closing time and say you want to do an inspection, and always obtain and document consent to inspect. One thing about underground storage tank inspections is they're usually done at the time of the annual monitoring certification testing. So that's usually pre-scheduled, and the facility is aware that you and the technician are going to be coming, and that there will be a disruption to their business. So it makes it a little bit easier to do the inspection, because usually everybody knows that it's going to happen ahead of time. So I'm going to turn it over to Lindsay now.
Okay, thank you, Greg. Okay, hopefully everyone can hear me. So let's talk about components and layout of a typical UST system. And that includes tanks, piping, sumps, dispensers, under dispenser containment, and of course leak detection equipment. So when I say typical UST system, that's going to be like your fueling station, your gas station. You've got tanks in the ground, sumps on the tanks, piping going to under dispenser containment, and up to the dispensers for fueling. And of course, your monitoring console, monitoring all the monitoring equipment that's usually located within the kiosk, or in the office area, somewhere where it can be heard, of course. So this is just a diagram of a typical tank, double wall tank. We've got the primary containment and secondary containment. So there's the two tank shells. There's the interstitial space or annular space, interchangeable terms. There's a sensor within that interstitial space. The yellow piping depicts vapor or vapor piping. So this would be a vent. All tanks need to be vented. The red depicts the product. This is the fill tube, where the fuel or product is entered into the tank. We have a tank gauging probe here connected to a monitoring console. And this is the tank sump with the product piping and the pump. So this is where the product is dispensed from the tank, pulled from the tank, and drawn to the dispenser. And this yellow piping is for return of vapors back to the tank system. Pretty standard setup. And it's not much different for a single wall tank. Just this has a single shell, so no interstitial space or angular space. This is a fiberglass tank, typical fiberglass tank. It's signified by the convex ends, got ribs. This is a very common type of tank that's used in an underground storage tank system. This is probably the most common that you'll see for use with subject to the regulations for hazardous materials in underground storage tanks. This is a steel tank, another common construction type for tanks used in underground storage tank for the storage of underground, hazardous materials in underground storage tanks. And it doesn't have the convex ends. It's got flat ends, smooth surface. And this one has a coating. It's kind of hard to see, but it's a red coating in this case, and that's to protect it from corrosion, which I'll talk about a little bit later. Tank risers are pipes that are connected to the tank top, whether they're regulated or not, depending on the year of installation, as Greg said, if they're installed, if the tank system is installed July 103 or later, these pipes would be regulated pipe and would require secondary containment. But the risers are there for the purpose of access to the tank, either for filling or extracting or to place monitoring equipment. So this one is a fill riser. This is where the product or the substance is entered into the tank. This is vapor recovery for volatile products like gasoline. You would want to extract the vapors in the process of filling the tank. So fuel goes in, vapors come out. This is a tank riser for an ATG probe, automatic tank gauging probe. And so it's to access that monitoring equipment or inventory control equipment. Fiberglass piping is probably the most common construction type for piping associated with underground storage tanks. This is your standard red thread fiberglass piping depicted by the red thread you can see in the pipe. Well, you may not be able to see them here, but if you look close at the picture, you can see. This is another type of fiberglass pipe, Amron dualloy. You don't need to know that, but this. And I wanted to show you pictures of construction so you could see what it looks like in the ground and you know what's going on, because you show up to a site for a typical inspection, everything is going to be buried. But this is what it looks like. This is a typical layout from dispensers connecting and then running down to the tanks. This is primary containment within secondary containment, obviously before the construction has been completed. But you can see how it fits inside. Flexible piping is another type of piping that's used for used in underground storage tank systems. And these are just a few different types of flexible piping you may see. Steel piping is also something that's used in connection with underground storage tanks, most typically above ground though. So you have above ground piping connected to underground piping, but of course it's still part of the UST system, because as long as the system is substantially beneath the ground surface, then it is part of this of the tank system. This system has flexible piping running up above ground, or it's underground piping that comes up and terminates right here. Well, actually terminates right here. The secondary terminates under these boots. So you've got double wall piping coming up and terminating here, and then turning into single wall steel piping. It is regulated, and later we'll talk about some exemptions associated with above ground piping, particularly with emergency generator tank systems, which is what this system happens to be. So what does the piping do? What is all this piping? So as I mentioned, tanks need to be vented. So we do have some vent piping that goes from each tank, usually consolidates into a common trench, and then runs to a transition sump where it then goes above the ground surface and up to a vent stack. Then you have product piping that runs. Each individual product runs from each tank to the dispensers. So these three pipes run up to the dispensers. Then you also have vapor return piping for fuels like gasoline to collect the vapors from the dispensing and run it back to the tanks. You have product going up to the dispensers and vapor returning back to the tanks. Just another view. Again, this is all construction. This is not a construction class, but I feel it's important to see the layout of how things look before they're buried so that you understand how the system works. So we've got the product piping, the three smaller pipes, and then the vapor return piping running back to the tanks. These are a couple pictures of double wall piping. So the fiberglass piping is a little easier to see. You've got the secondary containment by this larger sleeve here, which is commonly 3 inches in diameter, and the primary piping here, which is commonly 2 inches in diameter. On this side, we have flexible piping. The secondary sleeve is like a lighter blue over a medium blue for the primary piping, a much tighter fit. And these are test boots. They're not regulated components of the UST system, but they are there for the purpose of testing the secondary containment. So if one's broken and falling off, it's not necessarily a violation, but when it comes time to test the secondary containment, you're going to need to have a boot installed or some type of way to isolate the secondary containment for testing. So this is just a better picture of the flexible piping cross section, so you can see the primary containment and the secondary containment. When I first saw it in the field, I didn't believe it. I said, no, that's not double containment, that's not double wall piping. That's primary, that's single wall piping. I don't believe it, because I mean, look at, it's so tight. But apparently these little corrugated opening, that allows for drainage of any potential leaks from the primary containment into the secondary containment and to drain back to the sump. And what I didn't mention over here is that this does need to be open at the low point, typically a sump, so that if there is a leak in the primary containment, it's captured by the secondary containment and is allowed to drain by gravity into a low point into the sump to be monitored and detected for to alert the owner operator that there could be a problem with the system. There may be a leak. So there are three types of systems: pressurized, which is the most common, suction, and gravity, which is the least common. In a pressurized system, you have the submersible turbine pump, or the turbine, located pretty much at the tank top or close to the tank, where it's going to suck the fuel up from the tank and push it under pressure in the pipeline to the dispensing location, whether dispenser or day tank or other location. So in the dispenser, you're going to have monitoring equipment, maybe fuel blending equipment, but you're not going to have the pump that moves the fuel in the system. This is a diagram of a typical pressurized type system. You have the tank, the pump, the turbine right here, and it's pulling fuel out of the tank and then pushing it under pressure up this pipeline to the dispensing location. This is what a typical submersible turbine pump looks like if you were to open up the sump and see the pump there. At least, that's what it looks like when it's brand new. When you go out to any typical system, and we are talking about typical systems, it's not going to look that pretty. Unfortunately, it's usually pretty weathered. In a suction system, the pump is usually in the dispenser or away from the tank system, and it's sucking fuel all the way from the tank up to the dispensing location. So your dispenser, if there is one, is not going to have maybe monitoring or metering equipment, maybe blending equipment as well, but it's also going to have the pump that moves the fuel. There are two types of suction systems: conventional suction and safe or European suction. In a conventional suction system, there's either a foot valve or an angle check valve somewhere in the pipeline that's going to keep that fuel primed in the system to facilitate better dispensing. So you're going to have fuel held in the line past it, wherever that valve is, and up to the dispensing location. In a safe suction system, there's going to be no check valves in the piping, in the tank or in the piping, only one check valve at or near the dispenser at the grade level. This is a picture of a conventional suction system. You've got either a foot valve or an angle check valve here, and the fuel is going to remain primed in that line past that check valve point. So even if you're not dispensing, it's going to hold that fuel ready to go. In a safe suction system, it's not going to do that. There's a check valve here or somewhere located near the dispensing unit, but there are no valves anywhere in the piping or in the tank. So if someone not dispensing, anything that was in the line is going to drain by gravity back to the tank. They call it safe because if you picture, like say you're holding your finger over a straw filled with liquid, as soon as you lose suction, you move your finger, all that liquid's gonna drain out of the straw. It's just gonna fall back via gravity. So the same thing happens here. If you're, say the pump's on and you're pumping fuel, you're sucking fuel via suction to the dispenser, and a leak happens to the pipe. Well, what's gonna happen in a suction environment? If you get a leak there, you're likely gonna lose your suction. So if you lose your suction, that fuel or product is going to drain back into the tank and be a lot less likely to create a contamination to the environment than in another type of system. So that's hence why they call it a safe suction system, because it's not going to hold fuel in the line. In a gravity system, there are no pumps. Essentially, the gravity causes the product to flow from a higher location to a lower location. An example of that could be a remote fill, like this picture depicts, for say like a used oil tank. So you put the used oil here and it just drains via gravity into the underground tank. Much less common, as I mentioned. Tank sumps. Sumps are there to facilitate protection of equipment, say like piping and pumps, to keep it protected from backfill. And this is just what some typical sumps look like prior to being buried. Sumps could have flip-top lids or fiberglass or steel lids that completely remove. So this is a picture of a site that's just being opened for the purpose of testing, but it's obviously a completed site. And this is another construction type site. So we've got a piping sump here, a fill sump here, and you can tell that because of the buckets, and I'll show some more fill sumps in a minute. And then you've got an annular space reservoir here for wet interstitial monitoring, which I'll talk about later as well. So I can tell this is one tank, and this is one tank. So piping sumps obviously contain the piping connections. So the piping comes in, and usually the secondary terminates there, so you can monitor the primary piping. These have submersible turbine pumps, which tells me that this is a pressurized system. This piping sump does not have a pump in it, so that tells me it's a suction system. You just have the, in this case, as an emergency generator system, you have a supply and a return line coming back into the piping sump. And this would be a vent. A transition sump is usually one that transitions the piping from underground to above ground. This is a transition sump for vents. So you've got your underground vents coming into the sump and then going up to the vent stack to vertical orientation. And this is where the secondary ends. In this case, the vents have secondary containment, but as Greg mentioned, it depends on the construction. If they were pre-2003, they weren't considered to be piping and not required to have double containment. This is a fill sump. We've got the fill port here, or fill riser, and then this is vapor return, or vapor recovery. So as you're filling gasoline products, you're gonna drop the fuel here and extract the vapors at the same time on this side. These are typically depicted by orange caps. And this is a fill sump, but it's important to note that, again, depending on the year the system was installed, if the fill riser is not regulated as pipe, it wouldn't necessarily be required to have a containment sump around it. But if it is July 103 or later, it does need to have the containment. It is considered regulated pipe. So if it's pre-2003, July 03, it may just be direct buried. So it's not uncommon to see fill and vapor recovery buckets, ports just directly buried in the ground, in the concrete. You may see some atypical fill sumps or ports. For example, a remote fill might have a pipe connection in a box mounted to a wall above ground. This is just a very strange fill bucket. And is it approved? I don't know, you might have to look into it. Sometimes you go on site, you see things you have never seen before, you're gonna have to look into it and see, is it an approved component? This is just a sump with two fills and two vapor recoveries. It's to facilitate faster delivery and filling of the tank system. This is a fill port and a shop floor for a used oil tank. It's just a little hole in the floor and they lift the lid and they pour the used oil right in the floor and it looks kind of awkward, but they're out there. So each dispenser is required to have, or all dispensers are required to have under-dispenser containment. And this is what the under-dispenser containment typically looks like prior to being buried. And the purpose of the under-dispenser containment is to contain anything, any spills or releases or any type of leaks that happen from inside the components, inside the dispenser, any of the components inside there. So it would be captured in the under-dispenser containment and detected via monitoring equipment. When talking about leak detection equipment, I think the most important thing is the monitoring console. That's like your hub. That's going to receive all the signals from your leak detection equipment and tell you when something's an alarm and hopefully what that something is. Is it a sump? Is it a UDC? Is there something wrong with the piping? And hopefully, this is the most common type of monitoring console we see out there. Not to name names, but it is probably, 60-70% of the time, perhaps. And it's hard to read, but it says all functions normal, which is a good thing. They don't all say that, but when they do, that's a good thing. These are automatic tank gauging probes. These are typically used for inventory control, but they can also be used for monitoring and leak detection for single wall tanks, because you don't have that interstitial space to put a sensor in. You've just got the single shell, so you have to have a way to determine if that tank's leaking or not. So you've got the automatic tank gauge probe. The upper float, and they typically have two, the upper float is to monitor the fuel level or product level in the tank. So it'll tell you if you're getting too full or if you need a delivery, if you're getting too low. And the lower float usually tells you if there's any water in the tank. And typically they have a little bit, but you want to make sure they don't have too much. It's installed in a vertical orientation in the tank. And this is just a picture of the sump with the tank riser for installation. They take it out for testing sometimes. And so they lay it flat. This is just a sample of many different types of leak detection equipment, sensors and probes. There's all different types that you can have. Some are designed to be in wet environments. Some are designed to be in dry environments. Some are float mechanisms. Some are optical sensors. And we'll talk a little bit about the differences. And of course, these are the probes I just talked about. But there's a lot of different types of leak detection equipment. And a key thing to keep in mind is to check your references. So LG 113 is a very important local guidance letter available on the state's website. And that will tell you, what type of sensor it is. Is it approved for a fiberglass tank or is it approved for a steel tank? Can it be used with gas or diesel? Can it be used with used oil? All that information is in LG 113. So when you show up to a site and you see, and you see one of these sensors, this one, or say this one, you go, is that appropriate for this tank system? Well, you can find out from LG 113. There are two types of sensors, discriminating and non-discriminating. The discriminating sensors usually give a different alarm response for each liquid, say, for example, water versus fuel. And they may even have different detection points. This one here happens to have five different alarms on this one sensor. You've got a tamper alarm at the bottom, so if that sensor is raised, it's going to send an alarm response to the monitoring console saying, someone's lifted me. And then it also has three different monitoring locations or eyelets up the sensor here. One would be for water, because water's going to sit below fuel if there is fuel in there, so it's going to be at the low point. You have a low fuel and a high fuel. And then you also have a communication alarm. So if somebody goes and unplugs or disconnects that sensor, you're going to get alarm as well. These sensors tend to have a slow response and recovery, and they are also not common. Not very common, like 10 to 20% of the time. The much more common are the non-discriminating type. They activate the same alarm response, whether it's water or fuel, and they have typically a single detection point, a float mechanism or optical sensor. They have a quick response and recovery and are the most common types of sensors that we see out there. Line leak detectors are required for pressurized piping systems. And they monitor the pressure in the line to search for a leak. There's some criteria they have to meet, 3 gallon per hour at 10 PSI. And if they detect a leak that meets that criteria, they're supposed to trigger the appropriate response. Greg went over some of the acronyms. If it's a mechanical line leak detector, it needs to put the system into slow flow so that when you're pumping and you can't get barely anything out of it and you're getting really irritated, could be the leak detector putting the system into slow flow because it thinks maybe it's found a leak. If it's an electronic line leak detector, it's going to stop the flow of product to the dispenser. Under-dispenser containment can have electronic leak detection or mechanical leak detection. It's common to see both of these types. This is a sensor, a standard float sensor. so that if something leaks in the dispenser and it drips down here, it's going to pool and be caught by this sensor that's going to, it'll float and trigger an alarm to the monitoring console. In this situation, this is a mechanical device. This is a float. If fluid gets into under dispenser containment, it's going to pool in the low point here, make this float raise, which will pull down on this lever and pull on this chain and release the arm of the shear valve. The shear valve is a valve inside the product piping, typically around grade level, that will be open unless it is tripped. So when this, if there's a leak, it's gonna pull, close the valve, valve shuts, does not allow fuel to continue to go up into the dispenser. The shear valve is also commonly called the impact valve because, say, somebody loses control of their vehicle or plows over a dispenser. If they knock all that down, you don't want the fuel shooting up out of the, you know, out of the piping, because particularly in a pressurized system, which is the most common because it's the most efficient, most gas stations have pressurized systems because they want to get that fuel to the customer as quickly as possible. So if you've, you know, cut, if you run over that and open that up, you don't want it just pushing fuel out with no end. So the shear valve will shut that off and stop that from happening.
Sorry. Thank you, Lindsay. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the construction requirements as far as the statute and regulations are concerned. So primary containment for new UST systems, and again, remember we're talking about new UST systems, so on or after 1184, and upgrades or repairs to existing underground storage tank systems, so this is a situation where we get the older systems if they upgrade or repair them, have to be made of a material that's product type and compatible with the substance that's stored. Well, what does that mean? Okay, well, first of all, primary containment means the first level of containment, such as the portion of a tank that comes into immediate contact on its inner surface with the hazardous substances being stored. So if you have just a single wall tank, you're only going to have primary containment. Or if you have a double wall tank, it's the inner one. What does product type mean? Well, it means impervious to the substance that's contained or that's to be contained, and so as to prevent the seepage of the substance from the containment. You don't want to make a tank of a material where the product is just going to weep through it. That's going to be a problem for the environment. And compatible means the ability of two or more substances to maintain their respective physical and chemical properties upon contact with one another for the design life of the tank system under conditions likely to be encountered in a tank system. So in other words, it can't be compatible just long enough to pass this test or just compatible just long enough to get through this inspection. It has to be compatible for the remaining life of the system. And that means that construction materials have to be compatible with each other, and all those construction materials have to be compatible with the product or material that's being stored in the tank system. Secondary containment. All systems other than existing underground storage tank systems that store motor vehicle fuel have to have secondary containment now. So this is where we talked a little bit about the definition of motor vehicle fuel. So if there are scenarios where if it's a motor vehicle fuel tank, for a while, it's still allowed to be a single wall system. We'll talk a little bit more. That's going to be phased out in a few years. Secondary containment means the level of containment external to and separate from the primary containment. So that doesn't include laminated or clad materials. So if they have something that's sandwiched together, that is not a double wall system. That would be something that just has primary containment. It has to have a gap between them. And it might be a very, very narrow gap if it's a jacketed tank, or for example, the flexible piping example that Lindsay was showing. The gap between the inner and the outer the primary and secondary containment on those flexible lines is much narrower than it is with fiberglass lines, but there is a space between the inner and the outer, so it's a secondarily contained system. Secondary containment for new UST systems has to be constructed to prevent structural weakening as a result of contact with the released hazardous substances and capable of storing the hazardous substances for the maximum anticipated period of time necessary for recovery of the released substance. Secondary containment for new UST systems that are installed on or after July 1st, 2003 have to be product type. So this is a situation where for you have a number of generations of tanks. So it's like on or after July 1st of 2003, they have to be that additional level of protection with product type. Existing tanks that contain substances other than motor vehicle fuel were required to be retrofitted with secondary containment by December 22nd, 1998. And you would think that all these were taken care of, but we took over another jurisdiction's underground tanks not all that long ago, and we did find a few that had not been upgraded. So, but again, if they have motor vehicle fuel, for the time being, they are allowed to be single wall. Single wall steel tanks that hold motor vehicle fuel were required to be equipped with an approved internal lining or bladder system by December 22nd, 1998. So that doesn't just mean that any single wall tank system is okay for the next few years. No, if it was a fiberglass tank, it's fine. If it's a steel tank, then it had to be having an internal lining or bladder system. And December 22nd, 1998 was a huge upgrade date for underground storage tank systems. That was where we took a really old, a bunch of old tanks that many, some of that were not monitored or not monitored very well, that weren't protected from corrosion, didn't have spill containment, overfill prevention and stuff. And a whole bunch of retrofits were required by that date. So it was a huge project to make sure that all the tank systems and inventory were brought up to code by that deadline. All regulated piping other than non-metallic or cathodically protected motor vehicle fuel piping that was installed on or before July 1st of 1987 has to have primary containment. So here's a situation where we've got a little bit different date for piping. It phased in a little bit later than for the tanks themselves. Piping containment systems have to be sloped to cause unauthorized releases to flow to a collection sump located at a low point. Lindsay talked about that a little bit when she was showing the diagram. So if there's a leak from the primary pipe, it has to go into the secondary pipe, drain downhill to a point where it's collected, and there's a leak detection sensor there. Sumps that are part of a monitoring system is required under Article 3, which is the construction requirements for new tanks and monitoring requirements. Those are considered part of the secondary containment or leak detection system of the primary containment, and they're required to meet the appropriate construction criteria for new underground storage tanks. Under dispenser containment is required for any underground storage tank system that dispenses. So, whether it's a big truck stop, a small mom and pop gas station, a fleet fueling facility, if they're doing any kind of dispensing, the dispensers have to have under dispenser containment, which Lindsay talked about. That's basically the secondary containment. It's just the secondary containment pan or sump that will collect any leaks that come out of that dispenser. And it needs to be appropriately sized so that it can catch leaks from any portion of the footprint of that dispenser. So on some upgrades and retrofits, the newer generation of multi-product dispensers are, generally speaking, a much bigger footprint than the older ones were. So people like to come through and put these big old dispensers on these little bitty under dispenser containments. And they can do that in certain situations by using a conversion frame, but they have to have a proper conversion frame that's going to divert any releases from the entire footprint of that dispenser into the existing dispenser containment. If they can't get a conversion frame that's going to do that, then they're going to need to break concrete and replace the under dispenser containment with an appropriately sized one. But you can't have non-secondarily contained product piping or filters or metering equipment inside of the dispenser that are overhanging the concrete pad or the backfill. Everything inside that dispenser that has the product in it has to be directly overhanging the opening of the under dispenser containment or diverted into the under dispenser containment. Water intrusion is handled a couple different ways depending on when the tank systems were installed. So, for an underground tank system that was installed on or after July 1st of 2003, secondary containment actually has to be constructed to prevent any water intrusion into the system by precipitation, infiltration, or surface runoff. So they have to build it so it can handle having the pad washed down, it can handle rainstorms, any other source of water has to actually be prevented from getting into the secondary containment. If they don't do that, it's a violation for not constructing it properly. All containment systems have to be third-party approved. So the design and construction of primary containment and integral secondary containment in UST systems that were installed after January 1st of 84, so any new system, new UST system, have to be approved for use by an independent testing organization. For example, UL or Underwriters Laboratory. It can be another third-party approval, but oftentimes it's UL listing.
Each UST fill opening must be equipped with a liquid-tight spill container that is protected from corrosion, has a minimum capacity of 5 gallons, and either has a drain valve that allows drainage of collected spills in the containment, or another means to keep the container empty, like a hand pump. This is what a typical spill container looks like, aka a spill bucket. This is the fill spill bucket. And then vapor recovery spill bucket. This is a diagram that just shows here's the containment area of the bucket. This one has a drain valve to return the spill substance into the primary containment of the tank system. Otherwise, you would just the owner operator would have to remove it from the bucket itself. This is the fill pipe, and it's important to know that the 5 gallon capacity does not include volume inside the fill pipe. It's has to be the capacity that fits into the outer spill container. Each UST fill opening also must be equipped with an overfill prevention system which cannot allow for manual override. There are a few different types of overfill prevention mechanisms that can be used. One is to alert the transfer operator when the UST system is 90% full by either restricting the flow into the UST or by triggering an audible and visual alarm. So here's a picture of an ATG probe, an automatic tank gauging probe, which I talked about earlier. This probe monitors the liquid level of the product stored in the tank. When it gets to that 90%, it can send an audible and visual alarm to an alarm panel or equipment that's usually mounted to the exterior of a wall to give a very loud signal and a red light saying, hey, you're overfilling the tank. Please stop. It needs to be in a location that's close to the filling point so that the transfer operator is aware that they are overfilling the tank, if this is the mechanism that's chosen. Another option is to restrict the flow to the UST at least 30 minutes prior to overfilling the tank, provided that the restriction occurs that no more than 95% of the tank's capacity, and it triggers an audible and visual alarm, triggers an audible alarm at least 5 minutes prior to overfilling the tank. This is a complicated one, but the type of equipment that satisfies this option is a ball float valve. The way the ball float valve works is it's typically mounted to the inside the tank, the base of a vent riser, and when the fuel gets higher, it'll cause this ball float to float up and plug the vent pipe. And what happens in that case, if they continue to fill, you're not going to have venting, so you're going to get some back pressure from the buildup of vapors in the tank. And that's going to cause a restriction of filling the tank. So that's how they know that they're getting to that higher level. Another option is to provide positive shutoff of flow to the tank when the tank is no more than 95% full, or provide positive shutoff to the tank so that none of the tank top fittings are exposed due to overfilling of the tank. And the mechanism that satisfies either of these requirements is the fill tube shutoff valve, we have a question. We don't have a microphone for him. Explain the time frames. Yeah, that's a really good question. Can you explain the time frames on 30 minutes before? It's an option that's always confused me as well, but
Yeah, it's just basically that you have to have the restriction installed suitable that it's going to restrict it 30 minutes before the tank overflows. So it's dependent on the tank volume, basically, and how you're filling it.
Does that answer your question? Okay. Sorry, I didn't repeat the question. The question was explaining the time frames here. Is there any other question before I move on? Okay, so I was talking about the fill tube shut-off valve or the flapper valve. And the way this device works is as the fuel or the product level raises, it will cause this float to move up, and which in turn closes a valve in the fill tube. And once that fuel gets to that 95% level, hopefully it's installed at the correct position so that it will provide shut-off at 95%. Once it gets to that level, it should fully float and cause the valve to close in the fill tube and prevent any further filling of the tank. This is just an overview of a tank with the overfill prevention equipment and spill containment. So there's your spill container. Oops. There's your spill container and your fill tube shutoff valve or your flapper valve. And this is an ATG probe in the case that they're using that for overfill alarm. So overfill prevention is kind of a complicated topic, and there are a few different options and different ways to go about it. So the state has actually provided a local guidance letter, LG 150, which I find very useful. Definitely look into that, and explains it a little bit further, gives some good information. So LG 150 for overfill prevention explains it a little bit better. The UPA can waive the requirement for overfill prevention if certain conditions exist. And that is if the inlet is in the tank inlet is an observable area, the spill container is adequate to contain any spills from the filling of the tank, and that the system is not filled with any more than 25 gallons at one time. So as long as the operator is complying with those conditions, then the UPA has the discretion to waive the requirement for overfill prevention. In addition, all tank openings that could be used for manual dipsticking are required to have either a wear plate, which is a striker plate, or a drop tube mounted bottom protector. So what's manual dipsticking? So typically, like say a transfer operator would come and they want to check what's the volume of the tank before I start filling it. They'd drop a tube, drop a stick into the tank, and usually they'll do it with a good force because that way they don't have to fish it out, so they'll just kind of like throw it in the tank, let it bounce off the bottom of the tank, and they'll let it fly back up out of the drop tube so they can catch it. Well, when they do that, they're really hitting the bottom of the tank, and they do it every time as a delivery, or say in a situation with older tanks where they're doing manual inventory reconciliation, checking the level of the tank every day, and this is how they do it with a metered stick, throwing it in, bouncing it off the bottom of the tank. And they do that time in, time out, it creates, it damages the bottom of the tank. So the regulations for new tanks said, hey, you have to have a striker plate or a wear plate, something to protect the bottom of the tank from all this abuse, or a drop tube mounted bottom protector. And this is just a schematic from a new construction that shows the installation of a striker plate. And it's typically an 8x8 piece of metal that has to be at least an eighth inch thick. And in this case, it's showing that it's got that's a fiberglass coating to seal it to the bottom of the tank and make sure that it stays centered underneath any opening that is going to be used potentially for manual dipsticking. This is a picture of one of the different types of drop tube mounted bottom protectors. It's actually mounted to the inside or attached to the drop tube itself. It's not affixed to the actual tank. And it comes in, there's different types of this. Some of them look like a basket. This one's just got the arms and the bottom there to take the abuse instead of the tank itself. So all USD components are made of steel that are in contact with backfill need to be protected from corrosion. And there are a few different ways that we can go about providing corrosion protection, which is also known as cathodic protection. So there's isolation, or by the use of sacrificial anodes or impressed current. to, in the case of isolation, it could be, for example, a coated steel tank. I showed you a picture early on of a steel tank that had a red smooth surface. That was a coat. That was actually a coating for corrosion protection, so that it wouldn't degrade the tank in the backfill. Other types of isolation would be fiberglass secondary piping or sumps. In the case of sacrificial anodes, these are anodes that are placed around the tank in the backfill to sacrifice themselves and divert the corrosion away from the tank to themselves. And typically, corrosion is going to attack the weakest point. So these anodes are made of, say, like zinc or magnesium. They're going to corrode more readily than the steel itself. So they're going to take on the corrosion and divert it essentially away from the tank itself. This is a picture of a tank, a steel tank, that has two sacrificial anodes affixed to it to take on that corrosion and divert it from the tank. So they essentially sacrifice themselves. This is like a passive type of corrosion protection, in contrast to impressed current, which is an active type of corrosion protection. In this situation, there is a constant current being placed in the tank, in the backfill on the tank system to offset the corrosive effects of the backfill. So there's always a current there preventing the corrosion from happening. And in this situation, you have a rectifier to control that current. So you want to make sure that this rectifier, which is like another control panel that you should see inside the facility, that it has power, that the lights are on, that it's working, and that it is inspected every 60 days. That's a requirement for impressed current systems, because these are active type systems. Now I'm going to give a very brief overview on the construction of VPH systems, because again, as Greg mentioned, VPH systems will be covered later at other sessions at this conference. So the type of things that you will see with a VPH system, and again, we're talking about July 1, 2004 systems, tank installs and later, constant vacuum pressure or hydrostatic monitoring. So the type of construction to facilitate that, double wall sumps, double wall under dispenser containment, and constant monitoring on tanks, piping, sumps, and UDCs. So this is a picture of a double wall sump, piping sump. You can see the turbine pump there. And it's hydrostatically monitored. I know that because there's a reservoir right here. If you open this cap, you'd see a sensor submerged in liquid. And if the sensor's raised out of that liquid, the float's going to drop and it's going to trigger an alarm saying, oh, you know, we lost some monitoring fluid. This is a vacuum sensor box, which is there for monitoring, vacuum monitoring on piping. This is a vacuum line connected to the turbine pump because that is the source of its vacuum. These are pictures, closer pictures of that vacuum sensor box. It's hard to see, but inside that box there are two, in this case there are two vacuum sensors, which are monitoring the vacuum on each pipeline or each monitoring zone. Usually the zones would be like regular unleaded piping, and then another zone would be premium piping or diesel piping. And you have one sensor for each one. But that's just monitoring the vacuum. In your piping, you also want to make sure that you don't get any liquid in there, especially since it's under vacuum. You don't want that liquid sucked into the components, like, for example, the pump. So in addition, each zone has both a vacuum sensor as well as a liquid sensor, liquid float. This float here, if any liquid's introduced into the interstitial space, should trigger this float, should collect in this point, cause this float to go up, and provide positive shutoff in the case of the product piping zones so that you don't get it in the system. This is just a picture of a manifold, a vacuum manifold for vents. Vent systems, are the interstitial space is commonly manifolded into one zone. So you have a pipe. This is something you may see at a VPH system where you've got a vacuum hose connecting all three interstitial spaces for the vent lines. And this is a picture inside an under dispenser containment where there are vacuum valves for the interstitial space of each product pipe and vapor return pipe. These valves are closed. If you were to open them, you should hear hissing and have vacuum released which you would want to do if you were checking for communication along this system. Is there full zone communication? Do we have vacuum at the end of the line or all throughout that monitored zone? A way to achieve constant hydrostatic monitoring is by filling the tank with an interstitial fluid, like a brine solution. It's important to note that this is not new with BPH systems, with the July 104 construction requirements. This is actually a monitoring option that's been in place for a while, and some new tanks, pre-July 104 new tanks, have this already in place and are using this as a monitoring option. But all these other things are relatively, they're new technology for BPH requirements, to meet the BPH requirements. But that this is most commonly how double wall tanks meet the BPH requirements. Actually, I haven't seen anything else other than the hydrostatic monitoring of tanks. This is hydrostatic monitoring of an under dispenser containment pan. It's hard to see, but the fluid goes in between the very small space, the interstitial space in the wall, the UDC, and all throughout the bottom, all sides, everything up to grade. This is a reservoir for that liquid to monitor the height and also a sensor to detect if there's any loss of liquid. That, I felt, was essential so you'd know what you're looking at here, because this can be confusing if you don't have perspective. But this is a monitoring, a reservoir inside an under dispenser containment. There's the sensor, sorry for the dirty construction debris around here, but this site was just being opened. So the sensor's in there, so if the fluid is lost, then it should trigger an alarm. This is a sight glass on the opposite side of the UDC for the purpose of checking communication, making sure that if you adjust the fluid here, you should see a change over here. It should typically be on the opposite side, different level. So this one's connected to the bottom of the UDC, and this one's connected to the top somewhere on the opposite side. I'm going to switch it back over to her.
Okay, we're going to segue into operating requirements now. So, no person can own or operate an underground storage tank unless a permit for its operation has been issued by the local unified program agency. The UST owner operator has to submit a complete and accurate application for permit to operate to UST or for renewal of the permit. A lot of times they don't think they have to apply to renew, but they do before their expiration date. On their existing permit, they have to apply for renewal. And this is done through an electronic submittal via the CERS website or your local portal. We'll get into that in a little bit more detail in a while. They need to comply with conditions of the underground storage tank permit. So any applicable requirement of the permit issued for the operation of the system, you can put reasonable conditions on, even site-specific conditions if warranted, and they have to follow all those. Failure to do so is a violation of the Health and Safety Code. In a situation where the permit holder is not the underground storage tank operator, the permit holder has to enter into a written agreement with the operator that requires the operator to operate in compliance with the permit conditions, and they have to provide the operator with a summary of Health and Safety Code Section 25299. That's the section of Health and Safety Code that lists the violations for failure to comply with the California Underground Storage Tank Statute and the California Underground Storage Tank Regulations. So if the owner and the operator are the same, this is not an issue at all. If the permit is issued to the operator, this is not an issue at all. But if the permit is issued to somebody that is not the operator, this does apply. So in other words, if you issued a permit to the owner and they have, a dealer that operates the station, they would have to have a written agreement of this sort. And even though the CERS website has a link for uploading a PDF file of this document, there's no requirement actually for it to be submitted. It's helpful to us, but if they don't submit it, it's not a violation. They just have to have the agreement and they need to make it available for our review so that we can confirm that they do have such an agreement. Helps if they submit it. Every UST facility has to have an underground storage tank monitoring plan, so that needs to be submitted and kept current. It needs to be kept available at the underground storage tank facility. Now, this is something that has to be submitted via CERS or the electronic portal. And if the facility, however, has internet access and can log on to CERS, that satisfies the requirement for this plan to be kept at the site. So they don't necessarily have to have a hard copy if they have internet access at the site and can pull up the monitoring plan. If they don't, then they need a hard copy. So I've included the regulatory requirements for the content of the underground storage tank monitoring plan on the next couple of slides, but I'm not going to take up all of our valuable time going over that, but it is there for your reference. But basically, since the monitoring plan is a electronic form, essentially, for checking the box, fill in the blank on the storage website, they have to properly fill out that, answer all the applicable questions to have a compliant UST monitoring plan. To go along with the monitoring plan, they have to have a UST monitoring site plan. And what this is a diagram that shows the tank and piping layouts, locations where the monitoring is performed. So in other words, the locations of the monitoring console or consoles, sometimes we'll have more than one, locations of leak detection sensors, line leak detectors, if it was a single wall system, where the automatic tank gauging probes are. If it's a double wall system, from a compliance standpoint, we don't care about automatic tank gauging, that's strictly for inventory control. But if it's a single wall system, they should show where that is. And if it's a newer VPH monitored, vacuum pressure hydrostatic monitored system that uses vacuum monitoring, we would want this plot plan to site plan to show the location of the vacuum zones, because a lot of time can be spent when you do the annual inspection, you get out there, you don't know where this zone goes or that zone goes, the technician doesn't know where this zone goes or that zone goes. Saves a lot of time having a good plot plan like this, showing how the system is laid out. The important point to note is that the monitoring site plan oftentimes, in fact, usually is not satisfied just by having the business plan map. You have to have a storage map site plan with the hazardous materials business plan. Usually that won't have the information that's required in the monitoring plan on it. If it does, fine. They don't need to have a second map. They can just put provided elsewhere in SERS when they're submitting the underground storage tank information and note that it's in the business plan map. So they don't necessarily have to have two maps, but usually this will not be satisfied by the business plan map. They have to have an underground tank response plan. So that also has to be kept available at the facility. But again, having the internet access at the UST facility will satisfy this requirement. So if they can access SERS or your portal from the facility, they don't need a hard copy. If they can't, they do need a hard copy. And this is basically just saying how they're going to respond to a release from the underground storage tank. It has to demonstrate to the satisfaction of us, the UPA, that any unauthorized release will be removed from the secondary containment system within a time consistent with the ability of the secondary containment system to contain the hazardous substance, but not more than 30 calendar days or a longer time period as approved by the UPA. So I've included regulatory contents here on these slides. Again, I'm not going to use up our valuable time because we want to go to lunch, I think, on time. But it's there for your reference. Talked about it needing to be available on site, and the SERS Consolidated Emergency Response Contingency Plan, or the UNILOX Hazardous Materials Business Plan modules for electronic reporting emergency response plans and procedures for a hazardous materials business plan, do not typically have everything in there that's required of this response plan. It has much, if not most of it. So the model form that the states come up with, the one that's on UNIDOX for the UST response plan, it incorporates the business plan, emergency response plans and procedures by reference, and includes the stuff that's not included in that. But there's no required format for the UST response plan. It can be any format as long as it includes all of the required information. And if the business plans, emergency response plans and procedures do satisfy it, that's fine. When they're doing their electronic submittal of their underground tank information, they can put submitted elsewhere in SERS and just locate it, indicate in a comment that it's included in the business plan emergency response plans and procedures section. Underground storage tank financial responsibility is a subject that can be pretty confusing to new inspectors, especially because it includes a lot of business types of terms like assets, liabilities, net worth, specifics about insurance policies and things like that. So it can be really confusing, but basically the owner operator, and they're both responsible, of a UST in which petroleum is stored. Now this is key, it has to be a petroleum tank. So it's not a used oil tank, and it's not a, like a product that's not petroleum. They have to demonstrate financial responsibility for taking corrective action and or compensating third parties for bodily injury and property damage by an unauthorized release of petroleum. So in other words, if something goes wrong, they have to have assets to clean it up and to make right, at least up to a certain dollar amount, damages to third parties because of the release. Financial responsibility is demonstrated by submitting a certification of financial responsibility and by maintaining one or more supporting financial responsibility mechanisms. And there's a list of approved mechanisms that are specified in the laws and regulations. A couple of examples would be a chief financial officer or CFO letter that supports the use of the state underground storage cleanup fund, or an insurance policy that's worded exactly as specified in the regulations. The owner or operator has to maintain an updated copy of the certification of financial responsibility, and it has to be worded exactly as specified in Title 23. Now, they don't have to use that model form that's been provided by the state, but the wording has to be exactly as specified in the regulation. And it does need to be electronically submitted to CERS or to the electronic reporting portal, but that's done as a PDF file upload. It's not a fill in the form type of a thing. And this document and the other financial responsibility document, like the chief financial officer letters, they actually have to have a signature from the person that's submitting it. It's not covered by the electronic reporting e-signature. They actually have to sign it. And in the case of the certification of financial responsibility, it has to be, their signature has to be witnessed or notarized. And then they scan it and they upload it as a PDF document and electronically submit it. I forgot to mention for the underground tank response plan, they don't have to sign it. Even though the form has a place on there from the old days when it was submitted in hard copy for them to sign and date the plan, for the underground tank response plan, it's covered by the electronic reporting e-signature. So that, if they submit it unsigned, not a violation. Whoever submitted it by CERS certified it with their e-signature. But for financial responsibility documentation, it has to actually have a signature. The owner or operator has to notify the UPA of compliance with financial responsibility requirements when they apply for the initial permit to operate the tank and when applying for renewal of the permit. So they need to submit this through CERS before they start operation and before their permit expires to renew it. They have to update that certification of financial responsibility whenever the mechanisms used to demonstrate financial responsibility change. They can't just change and not let us know. The state board or we can require the owner operator to submit evidence of financial responsibility to demonstrate compliance with the financial responsibility requirements at any time. Usually this is already on file on CERS, and we can just review it then, but if we think that something may have changed, we can tell them to update that to make sure that it's still current. They have to maintain evidence of all mechanisms used to demonstrate financial responsibility in accordance with the financial responsibility requirements of Title 23. Until those requirements don't apply anymore. And they have to maintain it at the UST site or at their place of business. So it doesn't necessarily need to be at the UST site. It could be like at their main office or whatever, but they have to make it available if they don't have it at the UST facility and they haven't submitted it by CERS, they do need to make it available to us to review upon request. And they need to demonstrate the financial responsibility in required per occurrence and annual aggregate amounts. So it depends on the type of owner. If they're a marketer, which is basically anybody who sells petroleum, they have to have a minimum, and these are minimum amounts, of $1 million in per occurrence coverage. And if they're a non-marketer that has a monthly average throughput greater than 10,000 gallons, they also have to have $1 million If they're a non-marketer with monthly average throughput of less than or equal to 10,000 gallons, then they only have to have $500,000 demonstrated. So if they're a gas station, they have to have $1 million. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. I've seen a few gas stations submitted with 500,000. It doesn't matter what size they are, any gas station, any marketer, whether it's a major oil or a small mom and pop, it's $1 million per occurrence. The 500,000 would just apply to, say, a fleet fueling facility or somebody that's not selling gas, and also that has less than or equal to 10,000 gallons per month average throughput. Their annual aggregate amount depends on how many underground storage tanks that owner has, and that's nationwide. It's not just in your jurisdiction, and it's not just within California. So if they have from 1 to 100 tanks, underground tanks, they have to have $1 million minimum annual aggregate coverage. And if they have greater than 100 tanks, they have to have $2 million annual aggregate coverage. Many businesses demonstrate financial responsibility by using the state underground storage tank cleanup fund, or the state fund. So the state fund provides up to $1 million coverage. So as we've seen, some facilities have to demonstrate over and above that. The state fund won't cover the amount over $1 million. And in most cases, even if it's $1 million or less, the state fund does not provide 100% coverage. The amount of coverage that's not provided to state fund, which is similar to an insurance deductible, has to be provided by one or more supporting financial responsibility mechanisms. So they can't just say, I use the state fund, period. So the amount of financial responsibility that must be demonstrated exclusive of the state fund is dependent on what is called a priority class. And I won't get into the details of priority classes because for businesses it depends on how many employees they have, where they're located, where their principal officers are located. But the Petroleum Underground Storage Tank Financial Responsibility Guide is a great resource for answering any questions that you might have on financial responsibility. And I'll talk a minute about where you can find that. It's available on the web. But for priority class A, which is residential, basically single family or duplexes, they don't have to demonstrate anything. They can use the state fund for the entire amount. But again, that's single family or duplex. It's not a condo complex, it's not an apartment complex, it's for single family or duplex. Priority class B, which are small businesses, are $5,000 that they have to demonstrate exclusive of the fund. Priority class C, which is other businesses, $5,000. And priority class D, which is generally larger businesses or those that are not headquartered in California, $10,000. The most common mechanism that's used in support of the state fund is the chief financial officer letter or CFO letter. That letter has to demonstrate that the owner-operator has a net worth, which is assets minus liabilities, of at least 10 times the required deductible amount. So if they have a net worth that's less than $10,000, let's say they have to maintain $5,000, they have to cover $5,000 exclusive of the fund, they have to have a net worth of at least $50,000, or they can't use the CFO letter. And the wording has to be exactly as specified in the regulations. The letter has to be signed by the date on which the owner-operator commences use of the state fund, and it has to be renewed within 150 days after the close of each subsequent fiscal year. So for a sole proprietorship, their fiscal year is going to be the same as a calendar year. Many corporations will use a fiscal year that's not the calendar year. They might use July 1st through June 30th. But it needs to be renewed within 150 days after the close of whatever their fiscal year is. So you have to ask the question, hey, when's your fiscal year close? If they don't know that, then it's probably December 31st. And if it is December 31st, then it would pretty much be due on May 31st of the following year for them to renew it. That's even if they just recently submitted it. Let's say they submitted it in September, they started operation, and their fiscal year ends in December 31st. They don't get until next September, they have to do it by May 31st if their fiscal year ends at the end of the calendar year. So they can use any of the mechanisms that are authorized by the federal act, because the state act incorporates a lot of the federal act requirements by reference. So they can use any mechanism or combination of mechanisms to demonstrate financial responsibility. There's one mechanism that the state water board has created as a California specific mechanism, and that's a certificate of deposit payable to the state water board. But that can only be used in support of the state underground storage tank cleanup fund. So if they're using, they're not using the state fund or using some other mechanisms, they can't use the CD, and they can't use the CD on its own. Another commonly used mechanism is insurance, which is a pollution liability policy or an endorsement to an existing policy. General liability policies do not satisfy this requirement. In fact, they almost always exclude contamination from underground storage tank releases. So if they show you an insurance policy that's a general liability policy, it doesn't carry any weight for satisfying this. The wording of the policy or endorsement has to be exactly as specified in the regulations. There are a lot of other, not a lot, but there are a number of other acceptable financial responsibility mechanisms that are not quite as frequently used as the ones I just talked about. They're listed on the slides here. The important thing to remember is that state and federal facilities are exempt from financial responsibility requirements. So if you're inspecting a Caltrans facility or a Defense Department facility, any other state or federal facility, they don't have to comply with this. They are exempt. County facilities, special districts, cities do have to demonstrate financial responsibility. And then I've included a URL here for where on the UniDocs website you can find the financial responsibility guide. Everybody who's doing UST inspection should read that guide and be familiar with it, because it's a wealth of information with examples of this exact wording that has to be provided and examples of properly filled out certification of financial responsibility forms, CFO letters, etc. The next thing I want to talk about is designated underground storage tank operators. So a designated underground storage tank operator is not the quote operator of the tank. That would be like a business or an agency that actually operates a tank. A designated underground storage tank operator is an individual that meets certain criteria, and they do monthly inspections of the UST facility and provide facility training for the employees. So there's a lot of confusion about that. But basically, the underground tank owner has to submit information to the UPA identifying the persons who have current California UST system operator certification from ICC and who serve as designated underground storage tank operator, or DUSTO as we refer to it in our slides, for the facility. So they need to submit that as a PDF file upload via SIRS or your local portal. And this is another document where it doesn't actually have to have a signature, just the e-signature that's provided by the electronic signal will suffice. And then each designated operator has to renew their ICC, California UST System Operator certification every 24 months. And to confirm their certification, you can look at their wallet card. They have a new plastic card with a QR code on that. If you have a smartphone, you can get a QR reader. Read that, instantly check their certifications. If you have internet access through a smartphone, that's probably the quickest way to do it, not just by scanning their card, but also you can look them up if you have internet access at the URL that I've included down at the bottom of the slide there. But that's where you can confirm any ICC certification for technicians or for UST system operators. And the UST owner has to notify us within 30 days of any change in the designated operator. So they would just basically upload a new PDF copy of their notification and submit that through SIRS, but it needs to be done within 30 days of the change. They don't have to update the notification just because the designated operator's certification, ICC certification, renews. They only have to notify us of who the operators are and if those operators change. They don't have to notify us that the designated operator has renewed their ICC certification. The form is a little bit confusing and kind of implying that, but there's no regulatory requirement for that. The UST owner has to ensure that a qualified designated operator performs inspections of the facility's underground tank systems every month. So they need to look for certain things. So they need to look into the under dispenser containment. They need to look inside the spill buckets to make sure that everything's okay. They need to see if there have been any unexplained alarm events, leak alarms, not just like delivery needed or whatever, but a leak alarm, to make sure that they've all been appropriately addressed. If there looks like there hasn't been anybody looking inside a sump or an alarm goes off, at that point the designated operator needs to open the sump and do a visual inspection to see what the conditions are inside there. But they do need to open the spill buckets. They do need to open the under dispenser containment and look in those every month. The only time they have to open the sumps is if there's an unexplained, undocumented a leak alarm, and then they do that to try and figure out what the problem is. These slides indicate all the other things that they need to do, but again, for the sake of time, because we want to go to lunch, I won't read all of that word for word. The tank owner needs to be to ensure that there's at least one employee present during working hours, operating hours for the facility, who's been trained in the proper operation and maintenance of the system by the facility's designated operator. So they have to be trained by the designated operator, and there always has to be at least one person. That doesn't mean that everybody who's there has to be trained. There has to be one person with current training. Every facility employee with UST responsibilities who might work at a time when no other employee with current training for the designated operator is on site has to be trained. So if they might end up working unsupervised by a trained person, they have to be trained. And the training has to cover specific topics, you know, things like how to deal with alarms, how to deal with UST spills, overfills, and things like that. New employees have to be trained within 30 days of their date of hire, and refresher training has to be provided every 12 months. If the facility is not routinely staffed, the UST owner has to obtain approval from the EPA for an employee training program to be implemented by the designated operator, and the owner has to implement the approved training program. So if it's an unstaffed facility, they can't just say, oh, I don't have to train anybody, nobody works here. No, you have to have a training program, and you have to get approval from the UPA for that training program. So the State Water Board has provided FAQ guidance on this, and basically what they say about this is, quote, the training should be based on the spill, overfill, alarm, and emergency response procedures in place at the facility. An example of an unmanned UST facility is a remotely located emergency generator UST facility or a card lock style UST fueling facility. And I included the URL for that FAQ at the bottom of the slide. As far as record keeping for the designated operator inspection reports, they have to keep a copy at the facility of the most recent 12 months. It has to be kept on site or off-site at a readily available location if approved by the UPA. And that's a key point. They can't just say, well, our policy is we're gonna keep them off-site. It's like, well, no, if we didn't approve you keeping it off-site, it has to be kept on-site. And speaking for ourselves, we like it to be kept on-site because it's something critical for us to verify at the inspection, and it's not problematic for them to keep at the facility. If they wanna keep duplicate copies off-site, that's no problem, but we do need to have copies on-site. And then a copy of the alarm history report or log, along with the documentation describing corrective action taken in response to any leak alarm, has to be attached to each inspection record. So they can't just have the inspection report with no supporting documentation. They have to have the alarm history report or log, and then things that were done to fix the root cause of that alarm. And the inspection reports, again, not a required format, but it has required content. But there is a model form that the State Water Board has put out for that. So they have to keep a list of the facility employees that are trained by the designated operator. Current list of the facility employees has to be maintained off-site, and again, or off-site if approved by the UPA. And it has to include the dates of training for all facility employees and the hiring dates for all facility employees hired on or after July 1st, 2005. And it has to be provided to us upon request. So generally, we require that it be kept on site. Some facilities will keep individual employee training records. That's fine. But if they have more than one employee at the site who's trained by the designated operator, they have to keep a list. So just individual training records are not satisfactory, unless or if they just have one employee. I mean, that's a list of one. Got a definition here of what monitoring records are, because we'll be talking about it, but for all except the oldest, the really old systems, you're basically just talking about alarm logs and things like that, because all these other things like reading and sampling and stuff is usually for pretty archaic systems. We don't even have any of the systems that are really that old in our jurisdiction. But as far as alarm logs, The owner-operator has to maintain leak detection alarm logs and records of appropriate follow-up actions. And just like any other record, does need to be available for our inspection. For monitoring and maintenance records, monitoring and maintenance records, including records of repairs, linings, and upgrades, have to be maintained on-site, again, or off-site, if approved by us. Those records, if they're not kept on-site, they have to be made available to us upon request within 36 hours. So if you do agree for them to be kept off-site and they don't bring them out when you're going to the inspection, if we did agree for them to be anywhere other than on-site, we'd say, well, make sure you bring it on the day of inspection. But if they don't, they have to provide it within 36 hours. Monitoring and maintenance records have to be kept for at least 3 years. Written performance claims pertaining to release detection systems and calibration and maintenance records for release detection systems have to be kept for at least 5 years. Now, remember, the designated operator inspection reports only 12 months because those aren't technically a monitoring record. But for any of these other things, pretty much any other records, minimum is 3 years. Some of them are longer. Monitoring certification form, where they do the annual testing of the monitoring equipment, is considered a maintenance record for a release detection system, a calibration and maintenance record. So that's actually got to be kept for 5 years. Cathodic protection maintenance records, which is for corrosion protection systems, we'll talk a little bit about that, but those have to be kept for 6.5 years. And records of repairs, linings, and upgrades have to be maintained for the remaining life of the underground storage tank. Most facilities, especially if they change ownership, don't have that, but they are required to keep it for the remaining life of the UST. And this is one of my favorite requirements, one of my favorite sections of Health and Safety Code, because it's a catch-all if you don't have anything more specific. So records of underground tank monitoring, testing, repairs, and closure have to be kept in sufficient detail to enable the UPA to determine whether the UST systems are in compliance with applicable provisions of the UST law and regulations and their permit conditions. So obviously, if there's a more specific citation or requirement for a particular record, you want to use that. But if it's something that doesn't fall into one of those other citations, this is a nice catch-all for you being able to say, well, they're not documenting things well enough for you to confirm that they are in compliance. As far as unauthorized releases are concerned, basically, you know, leaks, overfills, things like that, any unauthorized release from primary containment, which the operator is able to clean up within 8 hours after the release was detected or should have been detected, and if it doesn't increase the hazard of fire or explosion and does not cause any deterioration of secondary containment, has to be recorded in the operator's monitoring records. So if it meets all those conditions, they do have to document it, but they don't necessarily have to report it. But they definitely have to document it. Any unauthorized release which escapes from secondary containment, or if they don't have a secondarily contained system that escapes from primary containment, because that goes straight into the backfill, or increases the hazard of fire explosion or causes any deterioration of secondary containment, has to be reported by an owner-operator within 24 hours after the release was detected or should have been detected. The owner-operator has to transmit to the UPA a written report within 5 working days of the release. So that means typically that's, you know, Mondays through Fridays, excluding state and federal holidays. So it, you know, doesn't mean if it happens on Friday that it's due 5 calendar days, but it's due 5 working days from the release. And it needs to describe the nature and volume of the release, corrective or remedial actions undertaken, and further corrective and remedial actions that they plan to take to deal with the release. Water and secondary containment, we talked a little bit about the newest systems where it's a violation for it not to be constructed to keep out water. So for those UST systems that were installed before that, new systems, not existing systems, but new systems that were installed between January 1st of 84 and June 30th of 2003, they don't have to construct it to make it watertight, but they do have to remove water from secondary containment, analyze it for hazardous substance contamination, and properly dispose of the contaminated water at an authorized disposal facility. So for those facilities, not a violation to have water, but it's a violation not to manage the water properly if they find it. For facilities where the UST was installed on or after July 1st of 2004, the secondary containment has to be operated and maintained to prevent any water intrusion into the system by precipitation, infiltration, or surface runoff. So if they're getting water in the secondary containment system for those newer systems, then that is a violation. Of course, they still have to properly manage the water. As we talked a little bit about compatibility, what compatibility means. Well, we're getting into an era now where we have fuels that are substantially different than they were some years back. They've got a lot of alcohols in them for air emissions requirements, for air quality requirements. They're putting alcohol into these blends. We've got new things like biodiesel blends and some other things that are starting to show up in, and people want to put them in underground storage tanks. But they can't just switch. They have to submit a document called an affirmative statement of compatibility for any components that don't have a third-party approval for compatibility with the substances they're going to be stored. So these original UL listings or third-party approvals that were issued for these tanks years ago didn't envision these high alcohol contents, certainly didn't envision biodiesel. So those approvals are for storing things like gasoline, diesel. They're not approvals for storing these alternative fuels. So before somebody switches to storing these alternative fuels, they have to submit an affirmative statement of compatibility to us that demonstrates that the system is going to be compatible with those fuels, because there are quite a few components that can not react well, you know, rust out or start degrading from contact with some of these materials. And it's important to note that the E85, which is 85% ethanol, is definitely an alternative fuel that would require this. Biodiesel greater than B5. So B5 is the percentage of biodiesel that's in the biodiesel blend. So if it's B5, that means it's 5% bio, 95% petroleum diesel. If it's B20, it's 20% bio, 80% petroleum diesel. Anything that's a biodiesel blend greater than B5 is requiring this compatibility demonstration. Up to and including B5 is covered by the third-party approval for diesel, because when they got UL approved for diesel, that included diesel blends with additives up to 5%. So the biodiesel up to B5 would just be considered a petroleum diesel blend with a biodiesel additive. Anything over B5, compatibility is a major issue. UST systems have to be operated in a manner that prevents spills, leaks, or overfill. So if the facility is not doing that, that's a violation of health and safety code. And they have to respond to a notice of violation. If we write somebody up for a violation, they have 30 calendar days to fix the problem and to comply with the permit conditions. And then the corrective action has to include all of the recommendations that we make in our notice of violations. They can't just blow us off. They actually have to do something about it. And generally speaking, agencies have a couple different ways. Some will do a reinspection, some will require return to compliance documentation, and some will kind of do a combination of the two. But we need to do our follow-up and make sure that all of these things are addressed and closed out. So now I'll turn it over to Lindsay again.
Thank you, Greg. I'm going to move on to monitoring requirements, but bear with me. We will take another break very soon. I'll try not to take too long in this section, but there's another break coming, so hold on. So UST systems, their leak detection must be installed, calibrated, operated, and maintained in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions. This includes their equipment and methods are also required to be certified by an independent third party. As I mentioned earlier, LG 113 is an excellent source. This is where you can find that information, so use that as a reference. Definitely be familiar with LG 113. That's where you can find that the equipment is third-party certified. Monitoring equipment also needs to be capable of detecting a leak from all portions of the UST system at the earliest possible opportunity. So say, for example, I talked about the tanks being cylindrical and round. You put a sump on top of that, well, when you look down at the sump, one side's going to be a low point and the other side's going to be a low point too, with a ridge in the middle, unless they've leveled that sump, which in some cases some owners did in the past, but typically you're going to see the tank top and, you know, two low points on either side. If the piping comes through one end and the sensor to detect leaks is on the opposite side of the tank ridge, then it's going to take liquid draining into the sump, filling up that side and spilling over the top ridge of the tank to the other side before that leak is detected. So that does not satisfy the detection at the earliest possible opportunity. In those situations, I ask the owner-operator to relocate that sensor to the other side as close as possible to the opening of the piping. The owner-operator must not disable or tamper with UST system leak detection equipment in a manner that prevents the system from detecting a leak or alerting the owner-operator of the leak. So it's not uncommon for systems to get water in them, rainwater gets in them when they're not prior to the July 103 requirement to prevent water intrusion. So the sensors will usually trigger an alarm for the water coming in there, and so owners get irritated with that. Sometimes they'll tie the sensors up at a higher location to give themselves more time to prevent that annoying alarm from going off. So in the case where they're going to raise a sensor, that's definitely tampering and that's not allowed. That would be a violation. So monitoring of new tanks, again, January 1, 1984 through June 30th, 2004, new tanks. They need to be equipped with an approved interstitial monitoring system that can detect leaks of hazardous materials from the primary containment into the secondary containment, as well as water intrusion into the secondary containment. And I'll show you some examples of how to accomplish that. New UST systems also need to have functional audible and visual alarms that activate when a leak of hazardous materials from primary containment goes into secondary containment and when water intrusion is detected in secondary containment. So this is a picture of a secondary, a dumping wall tank. This is a dry interstitial space or annular space, and you would put a sensor in the interstitial space there, one that's approved for a dry environment, so check LG-113, of course. This is what a typical sensor would look like for a double wall steel tank. This straight drop down to the flat surface member. It's not the convex tank like the fiberglass is. So you'd have this little, it's a float sensor. It's one of the options you can use for a double wall dry interstitial space for a steel tank. Drop it straight down and would give you an alarm if a leak is detected. For monitoring of dry interstitial spaces for fiberglass tanks, you would need a different type of sensor because, again, you have the convex ends. You can't just drop a sensor straight down in the interstitial space at one end of the tank. You would need what's typically called a wraparound sensor. So this sensor here, it's a float, simple float like many of the other types of sensors, but it's housed in a mesh wrap to protect it, and the service technician or installer needs to fish it around the tank itself. So it actually wraps around the tank and until the float gets to the proper position at the bottom of the tank to detect a leak at the earliest possible opportunity. You obviously don't want it the float up on the side there. So this is a picture of a service technician removing a wraparound sensor from a fiberglass tank. So he fishes it out by pulling one end of the rope and pushing or lightly letting down on the other end. And when he fishes it out, this is what it looks like. There's the float sensor inside the mesh housing. And they usually mark it with, you know, some dots to make sure that, you know, what's the correct upright position and also one along the rope so that when they fish it back in, they know that they get it into the correct position. Also, usually the alarm will stop going off when they get it in the right position. Another option for monitoring double wall tanks, as I briefly touched on with the VPH section, is wet interstitial monitoring. So again, this is something that's been in place even before VPH requirements, but they would essentially fill the interstitial space with a monitoring fluid such as brine. And then this is just a picture of the monitoring reservoir before it's been buried. You'd have a tank riser coming up and then access from ground surface. So this is that riser attached to that monitoring reservoir on the tank, and the type of sensor that would be used in a wet interstitial environment. This long one is called a dual point sensor. It has a float that will give you an alarm for both a high fluid situation or a low fluid situation. So if you were to lose interstitial monitoring fluid, you'd get an alarm, or if you were to get an increase, and I'll give you an example of how you could get increase in a second. A single float just gives you one leak alarm, and that would be if you lost interstitial monitoring fluid. So in normal operating conditions for wet interstitial spaces, this is what it would typically look like. It'd just be filled with a brine solution, set to a standard level in the monitoring reservoir. A sensor would be dropped in there, and you'd have a little bit of variation, but essentially if you lost fluid, you'd get an alarm, or if it's a dual point, you'd also get an alarm for raising. But this is what it should look like in a normal operating position. If you were to have a breach in the inner wall, the inner tank, what would likely happen is the interstitial monitoring fluid would enter into the tank, into the primary containment, and blend with the fuel or whatever the product is in there until the liquid levels would equalize. So you drain down till you match whatever the level is of the product stored in the tank. The liquid wants to equalize. And of course you should get an alarm from the sensor in the monitoring reservoir. Other options that can happen: if there's an outer wall breach, you could lose that monitoring fluid out into the tank backfill. And that would be a situation where, say, your groundwater level is at a lower level. So you would lose monitoring fluid until it equilibrates or matches with the groundwater outside the tank, you could lose all of it if you have low groundwater. In a situation where, I don't know what's going on with my graphic here, but in a situation with high groundwater, you might actually get an increase in the interstitial monitoring fluid because, again, the levels want to equalize. So this monitoring fluid would raise until it matches whatever the high groundwater level is in the backfill. So in that situation, you wouldn't want a single point float. You wouldn't want a single point sensor. You'd want a dual point sensor so that you could detect that increase in monitoring fluid in the interstitial space. So monitoring of double wall piping, secondary containment for piping including UDC must be equipped with a continuous monitoring system that either activates an audible and visual alarm or stops the flow of product at the dispenser when a leak is detected. These are some pictures of how to achieve that pipe monitoring. So again, you've got a sensor situated at the low point at the opening of the pipe, and these sensors typically need to give you an audible and visual alarm and in many cases provide pump shutdown. So here's the primary piping, the secondary piping, which needs to be open to allow for the drainage into the backfill, and then the sensor relatively close by so that it can detect that leak as soon as possible. Here's another option for pipe monitoring. Again, I talked about this a little bit earlier where you have, if there's a leak, it would activate this float and trip the shear valve and provide positive shutoff of flow to the dispenser. Piping secondary containment must be open to allow for liquid to fully drain, as I talked about in the previous picture, so that it flows from the low end into a monitored sump. So the test boot needs to be pulled back so that you can allow for that monitoring to happen. And this is just a picture of a couple situations where they are not meeting that requirement. And I talked about this test boot, again, is not a regulated component. It's there to facilitate testing of the secondary containment. But if it is left on and in a position that doesn't allow for drainage into the sump for adequate pipe monitoring, then that is a violation. It is an obstruction of pipe monitoring. So in this case, it's kind of hard to see, but the valve stem actually has a cap on it. And in this one, it's pointed upward. The boot is allowed to remain affixed over the piping. Sometimes there's space issues where they can't pull it back all the way to provide opening to that secondary containment. But it can remain on the piping only in a situation where this valve stem, the valve is pointed downward and the stem, the pin is removed to allow free drainage of fluid into the sump.
So there are some exemptions for underground storage tank piping systems to make them not be regulated under the California Underground Storage Tank Regulations. One of those examples is for unburied marina piping. So if it's a marina where they're fueling boats, if it's unburied piping, the operator can perform and document inspections of the piping that will exempt them from having that unburied portion of the piping be regulated. Another exemption that you'll probably find much more often than the marina one, especially if you're inland and don't have lakes, would be the emergency generator tank system, or EGTS, unburied piping exemption. This one comes up a lot for emergency generator tank systems. So again, unburied fuel piping, it has to be unburied, that's connected to an emergency generator tank system. It can be exempted from the UST regulations if the operator conducts visual inspections of the piping each time the tank system is operated, but not less monthly, and they maintain a log of the inspection results for review by us during our inspections. So key thing is, it has to be unburied piping. They have to perform and document these visual inspections of all portions of the unburied piping. And they need to do it each time the system is operated, but not less than monthly. A lot of facilities will just say, oh, I inspect it monthly. It's like, okay, great, but how often does your pump come on? Well, but we, okay, well, maybe we inspect, we run the generator a couple times a month or whatever. Well, every time that the pump comes on to transfer fuel, that inspection would have to be performed. It's not just monthly, it's not less than monthly, but each time the system is operated. What is an emergency generator tank system? Well, it's an underground storage tank system that provides power supply in the event of a commercial power failure, stores diesel fuel, and is used solely in connection with an emergency system, legally required standby system, or optional standby system as defined in the National Electrical Code. So it has to be a diesel tank, not a kerosene tank, a diesel tank, and it has to provide backup power. This is not for boilers. So if they have a underground tank system that's supplying a boiler, it's not an emergency generator tank system. If it supplies generators and a boiler, it's not an emergency generator tank system. Is somebody asking a question? I can't tell. Oh, okay. I've included the definitions here from the electric code for an emergency system, legally required standby system, and optional standby system. This is a good reference for you. You won't find this anywhere in the underground storage tank regulations or in the statute. It's referred to, it's incorporated by reference, and if you don't have a copy of the National Electrical Code, this is word for word the definitions of those systems. So, monitoring of double wall pressurized piping for new UST systems. Now we're back into, it's important to know what date the system went in. They, generally speaking, have to have a line leak detector. So underground double wall pressurized piping must be equipped with an approved automatic line leak detector that's capable of detecting a 3 gallon per hour leak rate at 10 PSI within 1 hour and either restricting or shutting off the flow of product when a leak is detected. So the thing about, Lindsay was talking about monitoring a secondary containment, interstitial monitoring. A line leak detector is actually monitoring primary containment. It's monitoring the pressure inside of that primary pipe, and it's looking for a leak. Generally speaking, it's looking for what is called a catastrophic line leak, which is the 3 gallon per hour leak rate or more. So hypothetically speaking, you could have a leak, but if it's less than that rate, it won't necessarily detect it. Some of the systems, some of the leak detectors can detect it, but you can't count on it to detect it. This is a backup because we're talking about secondarily contained piping. This is a redundant system. This is, in case your interstitial monitoring fails, at least you'll know if you have a catastrophic line leak. This is an example here of line leak detectors. So here we have an electronic line leak detector. This one is mounted right on the top of the turbine or submersible turbine pump. Line leak detectors can be monitored, can be mounted anywhere in the system though. They don't have to be on top of the turbine, they can be pretty much anywhere. This is an example of a very commonly found model of a mechanical line leak detector. And this one does have to be mounted on the turbine because the electronics can monitor pretty much everything upstream and downstream. The mechanicals can only monitor for leaks that are downstream of where they're located, so they have to be right on the turbine head. Otherwise, you could have a leak further back and they wouldn't know it. There is an exemption for emergency generator tank systems if certain criteria are met. from having a line leak detector, and this applies only to emergency generator tank systems, not to motor vehicle fueling systems. So for an emergency generator tank system, the if they have an interstitial monitoring system that has audible and visual alarms in the event of a pipe leak or a malfunction of the monitoring system, they do satisfy the electronic line leak detector requirement as long as the monitoring system is checked every day, either by remote electronic access or by on-site visual inspections, and they have to keep a log of that. So if the facility where the generator is located performs and documents that daily inspection, and this means working days for the facility, of that monitoring system, showing that it's properly functioning, not an alarm, etc., they can be exempted from having a line leak detector. So turbine shutdown is not required for a generator system, but they have to have the audible and visual alarms that are functioning. For another requirement for new underground storage tank systems is annual line tightness testing. And all pressurized piping in any UST system that was installed between January 1st of 84 and June 30th of 2004 has to be tightness tested annually. Now, this doesn't apply, notice the cutoff June 30th, 2004. VPH systems, the newest generation of underground storage tank systems, are not subject to having annual line tightness testing. But the new systems that came before that, including the 1 year July 1st, 03 to the June 30th, 04, do have to have annual line tightness testing. So tightness testing has to be done. It's basically a 0.1 gallon per hour test, and it needs to be either done by a state licensed tank tester that you have come in and do a state approved line tightness test on it, or it can be done by an electronic line leak detector if it's programmed and to do a test like that. Just because you have an electronic line leak detector doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be programmed and configured to run these tests. A lot of electronic line leak detectors will just be programmed to do the 3 gallon per hour catastrophic test, but they can be programmed to do the 0.1. And if they are programmed and they do a successful test on that, that and this facility can show that they're doing an annual test, then they would not have to have the state licensed tank tester come in. But most facilities, regardless, are not going to do an annual line tightness test because there is this great fail-safe exemption. So if they have a monitoring system that's monitoring the secondary containment, the tightness testing requirement is satisfied if they have shutdown of the turbine in the event that a leak is detected. So for the under dispenser containment portion of it, they have to have an alarm if there's a leak, and they have to have an alarm if there's a an alarm if there's a leak, and they have to have an alarm if there's a sensor failure. For any other secondary containment, it would be like for piping sumps, they have to have those two alarms, but they also have to have actual turbine shutdown if there's either a failure or a release. Most facilities will program the turbine to shut down for all three, regardless of the type of secondary containment that they have. They don't normally distinguish between under dispenser containment and other piping secondary containment, but there's a subtle difference as far as what the actual requirement is there. So if they have fail-safe shutdown programmed in, they do not have to do the annual line tightness testing. Fail-safe means that the monitoring system shuts down the turbine pump in the event of a power outage or when the monitoring system fails or is disconnected. So for a commonly used brand of monitoring equipment, I'm not going to go into it, but name the brand, but very commonly found, they have three different modes of alarms, typically for sensors. They will have a leak alarm. That means that it's detected that there's a liquid in the secondary containment. And then they will have a sensor out alarm, which means that the wiring has been cut. And then they will have a short alarm, which means that the wiring in the that leads to that sensor has shorted out and is in contact with each other because these systems monitor resistance. So for fail-safe shutdown for those systems, they have to have all of those modes providing shutdown. They have to have a leak alarm, short alarm, and sensor out alarm shutting it down. If they don't, then they're not properly configured for this fail-safe exemption. So let's jump over to monitoring of existing tanks for a moment. So the system has to be outfitted with a monitoring system capable of detecting an unauthorized release of the hazardous substance stored. Now that's pretty straightforward, but this is where in the existing tank systems you can run into a greater variety of ways of satisfying that requirement. And again, existing tanks are tanks installed before January 1st of 1984. Monitoring requirements for existing tanks are described in Article 4. So again, don't routinely think, oh, well, the requirements of Article 3 apply to these. No, Article 4 is what covers existing tanks. There is an exception I'll talk about in a minute. So there are different monitoring methods that they can use that are specified in the regulation for monitoring these existing tanks, which generally speaking are single wall tanks. So, but a couple of the methods that are listed in the regulations, even though we're a long time after December 22nd, 1998, there are still two methods in the regulations that refer to manual inventory reconciliation plus annual tank integrity testing or monthly 0.1 gallon per hour automatic tank gauging. So even though those two options still appear in the regulations, facilities cannot use those because there's a section 2646B that says after December 22nd, 1998, manual inventory reconciliation cannot be used to satisfy underground storage tank monitoring requirements. They can still do it if they want to keep track of their inventory or whatever, but it can't be part of their monitoring program, which means that those two options are no longer allowed. So I kind of wish they would take those out. And manual inventory reconciliation, as Lindsay indicated, is where they take a long stick that's calibrated and they pull it up and they look at the fuel level and they have a tank chart that shows, you know, whatever depth, height, whatever height in the tank that the product is sticking at, that corresponds to this many gallons, and they do calculations and they try and calculate whether they've got a leak or not. Not the most precise method. This is a commonly used way of monitoring single wall underground storage tanks. Continuous in-tank leak detection, or CITLD. So it's used to monitor single wall tanks. They also have double wall program tanks that are programmed to do this, but it's not a requirement. That's just because facilities will sometimes just like to have a backup. But for single wall tanks, CITLD, the important thing to remember about this is it's an in-tank gauging method. It uses very similar equipment to automatic tank gauging, the same probes many times, but it uses different software. And the key thing to make sure if they are using this is that you look at the local guidance letter 113, which is the list of leak detection equipment and methods for underground storage tanks that's on the State Water Board website. You have to make sure that they have the system programmed to meet the conditions for approval. So there's one commonly used manufacturer's CITLD system. It has two different modes. It could be a 0.1 gallon per hour mode or a 0.2 gallon per hour mode, and it has to be, it has a 99% level and another level, and it has to be set at the 99% level in the system setup. So you need to look at the system setup report that is printed out by the technician from the monitoring system console to make sure that it's properly programmed and operating in accordance with the third-party approval conditions. If not, then it's a violation for using CITLD appropriately. So automatic tank gauging is another method used to monitor single wall tanks. Again, some people will use it, many people will use it to also run tests on a double wall tank, but these are never required for double wall tanks. But for a single wall tank, you have to provide monitoring. These are two methods that you can satisfy the requirement. It needs to perform a valid monthly 0.2 gallon per hour leak test, generate appropriate hard copy reports, and then the regulations tell you the information that needs to be in those reports. And it has to be, just like with the CITLD, it has to be operated in accordance with the conditions in LG 113. Very important. So, what's the difference between CITLD and automatic tank gauging? As I said, they use very similar equipment. The main difference is that CITLD uses different software, and it can aggregate data from multiple short-term idle periods in the tank. So an idle period is a period when you're not putting any product into the tank, you're not dispensing any product out of the tank. So it's just sitting there static, and this is a time where the system can take data over a particular period of time. For an automatic tank gauging system, it has to have several hours of uninterrupted time to take one interrupted sample of that data. And you, generally speaking, have to have a relatively high product level in the tank to get a valid test. The time intervals and the product minimum product levels are in specified in LG 113. That's why it's so important to be familiar with that for these systems. The CITLD can aggregate data over a whole bunch of shorter term periods. So you might have 10 minutes here, 20 minutes there, or whatever. And the CITL will aggregate that to get a test. There are situations where if you have a really busy facility, say a truck stop or something, they may never have enough idle periods even for a CITLD system to get valid tests, in which case they would have to take the tank out of service long enough for them to get a valid test. Generally speaking, for these automatic tank gauging systems, if they're not a 24/7 facility, they usually have them scheduled to happen in the dead of night when everything is nice and quiet and nothing's dispensing. Statistical inventory reconciliation, or SIR, is another method that is approved. Not a huge number of facilities are using it, but basically, if they are using it, they have to take precise inventory levels and they have to do some calculations to determine whether or not they're having a release. It could be a manual one, or they can send it off to a third party to crunch the data. It's not really widely used, but if you do have a facility that's using SIR, please read the regulatory requirements for SIR in detail. And the State Water Board has a couple of local guidance letters that you need to be familiar with for using SIR and for reporting SIR results. So if they are using SIR, every year they need to submit to the UPA a report, a written statement indicating the results from the SIR reports for the previous 12 months. So they need to submit the information showing that they've been doing the SIR and what those test results were. Of course, if the SIR indicated that there was a problem, they can't wait 12 months to let you know. They need, if there's evidence of a leak, they need to report it, as we talked about earlier, for reporting purposes. So they have to take appropriate follow-up actions if there's a release, but basically, I'm not gonna go into all of this, but they need to inspect their, if the SIR indicates that there's a release, they need to review their inventory records to look for errors, have systems inspected by qualified people to see if there's any obvious leaks, and then have their meters, their dispenser meters checked and recalibrated if necessary. Because they have to not only measure the tanks, but they also have to have accurate readings from what's being dispensed, what's coming out of the tank. So manual tank gauging is an option for some smaller existing tanks. Again, none of these are applicable requirements for new tanks, but if they're using manual tank gauging, they have to do it exactly as specified in the regulations, section 2645. These are going to be in Article 4, which is a section that applies to existing underground tanks monitoring. Manual tank gauging is allowed only for single wall tanks that have a total system capacity of 1,000 gallons or less. So if they've got a bigger tank, they can't use this at all. The minimum test period is 36 hours with no liquid inputs or withdrawals allowed during the 12 hours preceding the gauging period. And if the tanks have a capacity of 551 gallons or more, they also have to have an annual tank integrity test unless the gauging period is 60 hours or more. You're not likely to run into this too much, but if you have a really old tank inventory, it's possible. What does tank integrity test mean? Well, it means a test method that can confirm the physical integrity of a UST. It includes only test methods that are able to detect a leak of 0.1 gallon per hour with a probability of detection of at least 95% and a probability of false alarm of 5% or less. Those are the tank tightness methods are tank tightness tests are all going to be done by a state licensed tank tester, and they have to use an approved test method. So you want to make sure that you see a copy of their tank tester license. So I mentioned there are a couple of exceptions to where you don't flip from one set of rules for existing to new, but there are exceptions. So the existing underground tank monitoring requirements in Article 4 don't apply to an existing UST if it's designed, constructed, installed, and monitored in accordance with the requirements of Article 3. So in other words, if this was something that was installed, you know, right up before the new tank regulations came in, and they installed the system to those standards, even though that deadline hadn't been met, that can be regulated under the standards for Article 3 requirements. And in the existing USTs that meet the construction and monitoring requirements of Article 3, they can be issued an operating permit according to the new tank requirements of Article 3, to the new tank requirements of Article 3 rather than the existing tank requirements of Article 4. You won't run into this too much, but it is a possibility. Existing UST systems, monitoring of the piping, it's going to be most likely a single wall system, although there are many systems that are single wall systems, existing tanks, where they've upgraded it to double wall. But let's say this is one that's not been upgraded. It's compliant single wall piping that's allowed, again, for motor vehicle fuel piping that's protected from corrosion, etc. So if they've got single wall pressurized piping, they have to have an electronic line leak detector. The mechanical line leak detector will not work to satisfy those requirements, because they have to have an electronic line leak detector capable of, they have to have a line leak detector. The regulations don't say electronic line leak detector. It says it has to have a line leak detector capable of detecting a 3 gallon per hour leak rate at 10 PSI within 1 hour, and it has to shut down the turbine when it detects a leak is disconnected or fails. So that's that, it's that last part there, shut down the turbine, that makes you have to have an electronic line leak detector to satisfy this, because a mechanical will not cause an alarm if it fails or if it's disconnected. Only an electronic line leak detector will do that. So all these single wall pressurized systems, again, the leak detector requirements only apply to pressurized piping, not suction or gravity. These single wall systems also have to have line tightness testing. So they need to be tightness tested by performing a 0.1 gallon per hour line integrity test annually or a 0.2 gallon per hour line integrity test on a monthly basis. But since these systems are already going to have an electronic line leak detector, yeah, you could have a state licensed tank tester come in and do this, but in practice, the electronic line leak detector that you've already got installed for your fail-safe shutdown capability will be able to be configured, and an important part of your inspection is to ensure that it is actually configured that way, but it will be configured to run these tests. So I've never seen a situation where they didn't have that that done that way, but you do want to make sure that, yeah, it's configured for fail-safe shutdown and is properly programmed to run these tests. So now let's move on to existing suction piping. So this is another situation that's not real common, but if you have a really old system, usually this would be like a very small, a construction company or somebody, they have a couple, a few vehicles that they fuel, they don't have a big throughput or whatever, so they still have this old, really old conventional piping system with no secondary containment, and it's a suction system. They can perform and document daily inspections of the suction piping to satisfy the monitoring requirements for that system, but they have to follow the requirements in Appendix 2 of the underground storage tank regulations. So if you look in the UST regulations, Appendix 2, it basically has a checklist for the things that they need to do to perform these inspections. If they're doing that and keeping that log on site, then they are satisfying one of the requirements for monitoring that piping. Now, another thing that they would have to do for that piping, in addition to doing that daily inspection, is they have to have it integrity tested every 36 months, and that would have to be done by a state licensed tank tester, because suction system, you're not going to have a line leak detector. Line leak detectors, again, are only for pressurized piping systems. So every 36 months, tightness test. Single wall gravity piping, line tightness testing applies to that as well. So it has to be integrity tested every 24 months by a state licensed tank tester. And if the piping can't be isolated from the underground storage tank, they can do what's called an overfilled volumetric tank tightness test. That's where they fill the whole thing up, flood the tank entirely, flood it all the way up to the end of the piping, and then they can have a state licensed tank tester do a test on that, a tightness test, and that would satisfy the requirement. Now I'm going to turn it over to Lindsay for a little bit to talk about enhanced leak detection.
Thank you, Greg. Okay, so to make it more complicated, even more monitoring requirements, if you're an owner-operator with a UST system that's located within 1,000 feet of a public drinking water well, you must conduct an enhanced leak detection testing if notified by the water board, and do that within 18 months of that water board notification. Additionally, if you're an owner-operator of a system that's within 1,000 feet of a drinking water well and you have a single wall component in your system, you have to do that initial testing within the notified time frame within 18 months, as well as continue that testing every 36 months thereafter. So what is enhanced leak detection? It's a test method that ascertains the integrity of a tank system by essentially inoculating the tank with something that's a different substance than that's part of the fuel formulation, and then checking for detection of it outside of the tank system. And we're talking about, also like a tracer. So we're talking about the primary containment. So you put something in the primary containment that's not part of the regular fuel formulation, and you check to see if it's detected outside the system. Does it escape? Is that tank, or is that tank system tight? The enhanced leak detection testing needs to be third-party certified, as well as detect both liquid and vapor phases and meet a leak detection of 0.005 gallon per hour, or detect leaks of a leak rate of 0.005 gallon per hour. This is just a picture of some testing equipment that's used. Enhanced leak detection is also used for testing of new installations, so they do it in an environment with double wall systems as well. But essentially they're putting something in the tank, and then giving it some time to settle, and then checking to see if it makes its way out. In the case of the new installation, they would run, for example, like pump helium into the tank, or inoculate the tank with helium, and then pass air through the secondary containment space and check for the presence of helium as they're passing that air through the secondary space. In a single wall tank system, they would check certain locations in the backfill or surrounding the tank to check for the presence of that tracer material to see if it escaped into the environment. So if the enhanced leak detection program or testing indicates that there's any problem with the UST component that is leaking, either liquid or vapor, then the owner operator needs to take appropriate actions to remedy that situation and continue to do the testing until they receive the passing test. So keep repeating the enhanced leak detection testing and program until they get a tight system, essentially. And once the testing is complete, they need to submit the testing results to both the CUPA and the Water Board within 60 days of completion of testing. So in addition, the annual requirement for all underground storage tank systems is that the leak detection equipment needs to be tested and certified every 12 months by an International Code Council certified California UST service technician that has current training from the manufacturer of the monitoring equipment that's being tested. This is a picture of typical monitoring system certification being performed. So they've got the tank pad flagged off to protect, you know, people from just walking into an open sump. They open the manways and sumps and to access all the leak detection equipment. They remove the leak detection equipment and test it. Typically, the standard is to test it in water if it's a typical float sensor. So you pull the sensor out of the tank system. In this case, we're looking at an interstitial space of a tank, so a tank annular space, and it's going to be a steel tank because it's a straight drop sensor. Here's a blow up of that picture, and it's hard to see, but there's a cup of water right there. They'll remove that simple float sensor, drop it in the cup of water, and make sure and to see if it detects a leak. That's to simulate an environment of, say, you know, if that primary tank were to leak, or if water intrusion were to get into the secondary containment, would that sensor detect it? Historically, they would just take the sensors and flip them upside down, and you know, or shake the floats and activate the float, but we really want to see it tested in liquid to simulate what would happen in a leak type situation. This is a picture of testing a couple different testing apparatuses for the purpose of checking line leak detectors to make sure that they are functioning properly and can detect the required leak of 3 gallons per hour at 10 psi. So they will tap into the system by a port near the shear, just below the shear valve in the product piping as it comes up into the dispenser, and simulate that 3 gallon per hour leak and see if that leak detector detects it and either puts the system in the slow flow if it's a mechanical leak detector, or shuts down, stops the flow of product at the dispenser, shuts the pump off if it's an electronic line leak detector. Following the annual testing, and that's testing of all the sensors and leak detection equipment components at each individual site, depending on what that is. Each site's a little bit different, but they're going to have, if they have double wall tanks, they'll have interstitial sensors and piping sensors and the sumps. And once all that's tested and certified, a report's required to be submitted on a standardized form. This is a required form, the monitoring system certification, along with any attachments like a system setup or alarm history report. That is required to be submitted to the UPA within 30 days of completion of testing. And if it's a system that doesn't generate an alarm history report, the station owner operator is required to maintain an alarm a log or some type of history of alarms that have taken place. So that would need to be attached to the monitoring system certification. So it's not good to say, well, my monitoring console doesn't create a printout. It doesn't do that. Well, then you need to attach your handwritten alarm log. This is the actual required format. It's hard to see, but that's the form that service technicians need to submit their testing results on within 30 days. Spill containers also need to be tested once a year. The spill buckets surrounding the fill ports. So they need to be tested annually to confirm that they have the ability to contain any hazardous substances released until they can be removed. This is a picture of a couple different types or a couple different ways to test spill containers. Hydrostatic is by far the most common method we see to test. And they can just do a simple hour-long test if they like, fill it up, fill it with water, and take a tape measure, take a look at the level, check it back in an hour and make sure that there's no loss. If there's no loss, then that would be a passing result. Or they could do an accelerated hydrostatic test, as what they're doing in this picture. This is a liquid level probe it's a float device, and it's pretty accurate. It can detect up to 1/2000th of an inch change in the liquid level. So it will tell you an increase or a decrease if it detects it up to 1/2000th of an inch. And that way, they could do a 15-minute test in lieu of an hour test if they go with the accelerated hydrostatic way. This is, we don't see this very often, but it is out there. They can perform a vacuum test on the spill containers. And they would just fit this apparatus into the top of the spill container, pull a vacuum on that bucket, and if they can hold it for an hour is what we look for, then you know it's a passing result. But if they lose vacuum, it's a fail.
That's a 60-second test for vacuum.
Is it? I've heard. Okay, I guess 60-second test. I've heard different things, but again, not very common. Thanks, Greg. Secondary containment systems, secondary containment components also need to be tested upon installation every 6 months. Or 6 months after that, and then within 36 months thereafter. So I'm sorry, upon installation, within 6 months of installation, and every 36 months thereafter. So that includes even if you have an existing system or a new existing system that has secondary containment components, if you repair or replace those components, yes, you do need to repeat that secondary containment test, and then 6 months thereafter, and then get back on your every 36-month schedule. So what needs to be tested? Essentially anything that provides secondary containment for regulated components. So sumps, tanks, piping, anything that, like I said, provides containment for regulated components. This is a picture of secondary piping being tested. As I mentioned, the test boots, typically we want to see them pulled back so you can provide monitoring communication. So if a leak is detected, a leak happens, you want to be able to detect it. But that boot's there for the purpose of testing. So when they're doing the secondary containment test, they'll fix the boot over the opening of the secondary pipe and isolate that off and pull a, pressurize. Typically they'll do about 5 psi pressure on the secondary containment piping and check that for 1 hour. If it holds about 5 psi for 60 minutes, then it's considered to be a tight secondary containment pipe. Tanks are typically tested via vacuum, and it depends on the type and size of the tank, but usually between 6 or 7 and 10 inches of mercury vacuum they pull on a tank and watch it for an hour to make sure that there's zero loss as well. Under dispenser containment and sumps are typically tested with water. So they'll do a hydrostatic test on the sumps to see if they're tight. Fill it up to above piping penetrations, trying to avoid conduits if possible, but if the conduits are installed to penetrate the sumps or EDCs below piping penetrations, then you're kind of stuck putting them underwater. But they'll fill the EDC or fill the sump and check it for 60 minutes, unless they're doing, not 60 minutes, it would be equivalent. It'd be 24, I'll talk about that in a minute, but often they'll do the hydrostatic means on, hydrostatic test method on this, where they'll put the advanced equipment in there and check it for 15 minutes and see if there's a loss of 1/2000ths of an inch. That's the most common that we see. This is what I was about to say. So the secondary containment components need to be tested to the same standard that they met upon installation. So historically we would do a 24-hour hydrostatic test on the sumps and UDCs. So if they aren't using an accelerated method, then technically they need to do a 24-hour test when conducting secondary containment testing, because that would match the same standard. It held for 24 hours initially, so let's see that it does that again, unless, again, they want to use the accelerated method, which is equivalent. The testing needs to be performed per the manufacturer's guidelines or standards. If there are no manufacturer guidelines or standards, you would use an industry code or engineering standard. And if that's not available, then you would go with a test method that's approved by a state-registered professional engineer. Secondary containment needs to be done by a licensed tank tester or a UST service technician, a certified UST service technician, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And the test results need to be submitted to the CUPA within 30 days of completion of testing. Secondary containment components that where the continuous monitoring system automatically monitors both primary and secondary containment at the same time, such as like for constant vacuum, constant pressure, or hydrostatic method, that satisfies the requirement for secondary containment testing. So if it's a VPH system, they are not required to do the periodic secondary containment testing. Or if they have a new tank, a double wall tank that's hydrostatically monitored for its regular monitoring, then that component is exempt. So maybe they have liquid interstitial space for the tank, and then open secondary piping, which is typical. They would need to test the secondary piping, but they would not need to test the secondary tank. Back over to you.
Okay, sorry about that. So, for line tank inspections and certification, so this normally applies to existing tank systems, single wall tanks that had to be lined as part of a upgrade. But line tanks can also be lined as part of a repair. So it is possible to have double wall systems, new systems that have been lined. So if the tank system has been lined as part of a repair or upgrade, the owner-operator needs to have the tank inspected by a coatings expert or a special inspector within 10 years of lining and every 5 years thereafter. So certainly for anything that was lined as part of the 98 upgrade requirements is on the 5-year schedule now. But if it was a more recent tank that was repaired, then it's possible they could have a 10-year inspection coming up. But after that first inspection, it goes to 5 years. Pardon me. So before the tank system is returned to service after having this inspection done on it, it needs to be given a tank integrity test. And again, this is done by a state licensed tank tester. The owner-operator needs to notify us at least 48 hours prior to conducting pretty much any kind of regulatory required testing. So before they do installation, repair, replacement, calibration, or certification of monitoring equipment, we need to get that notice. And I know the regulations say 48 hours, but we really don't like people calling us up at, you know, 4:30 p.m. on Friday and saying, hey, we're coming out Sunday evening. So we generally phrase that as a 2 working day requirement, but the regs do say 48 hours. Although our permit conditions do say that they have to coordinate that testing with our annual inspection, so we have them on the hook from that regard. They also need to notify us of 48 hours before secondary containment testing, tank or piping integrity testing, and enhanced leak detection testing. So for any of those things, they do have to give us a notification so that we have the option of coming out and watching them do that testing if we wish to do that. And we do, as an agency, coordinate our annual compliance inspection with the annual monitoring system certification testing, because that's a time when everything is opened up and accessible. We get a good look at it. It's not all sealed up. And we can actually verify that things are working as they're supposed to be working. For cathodic protection inspections, again, cathodic protection is a corrosion protection systems, the owner-operator has to perform and document inspections of impressed current systems every 60 days. So if they have one of those impressed current systems, they need to be inspecting the rectifier unit, making sure that it has power and it's set within the appropriate operating parameters, and they need to keep records of that. And we need to make sure that we're looking at that when we're out for an inspection. Occasionally you'll go out and you'll find out, oh, they've got the power turned off to the rectifier. Not a good thing. So field installed cathodic protection systems, they have to be designed and certified as adequate by a corrosion specialist. So they need to be tested by a cathodic protection tester within 6 months of installation and at least every 3 years thereafter. And then there's a local guidance letter, LG 145, that clarifies the difference between a corrosion specialist and a cathodic protection tester. The systems that have sacrificial anodes have to be tested by a qualified cathodic protection tester every 3 years in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions. So what they'll do is they'll come out, there's a lead wire that comes up, usually it's in the backfill in a sump somewhere, a backfill next to a sump somewhere, or next to a fill pipe, and they'll hook on a voltmeter to make sure that it has the appropriate voltage to show that it's still able to protect the system. If it's below that certain voltage, then the anode would need to be replaced, or they would need to install a impressed current system or provide some other method of protecting the tank from corrosion, or they would need to close the tank. A copy of the test report has to be submitted to us within 30 days of completion of the testing. So I've included the definitions here of cathodic protection tester and corrosion specialist, but again, the local guidance letter does go into more detail on that. Now I'm going to turn it back over to Lindsay for a little bit.
So did you cover this one already? You didn't cover this one? You didn't do this one? Okay.
Something's working to you.
Yeah, it's okay. Within 30 days of completion of tank or pipe integrity testing, the tank owner operator must provide the UPA with a report. Within 30 days of completion of the tank lining inspection, tank owner operator and the party performing the inspection must provide the UPA with a written certification of the inspection. So who can do what? What are the qualifications for testers, installers, service technicians, and who provides those certifications or qualifications. If you're a tank tester, then you're required to possess a valid tank testing license from the board, from the water board. If you're an installer of a tank installer of a UST system or component, you need to have a license and certification issued by the Contractor State License Board, or and possess a California UST installation and retrofitting certification from the Industrial Code Council, as well as have current training and certification from the manufacturers of the components that you're installing. If you're a service technician, then you have to possess, you need to meet a bunch of things, well, a few things. You need to have a Contract State License Board license, such as a Class A or C10, one of the following that are included in the code, or have or be an individual that has a tank testing license that's issued by the board. In addition, you need to possess a current California UST service technician certification issued by ICC, Industrial Code Council, as well as have current training certification from the developer of the test methods used for secondary containment testing, if that's what you're going to be doing, as well as training and certification from the manufacturer of the components that you'll be testing or calibrating or certifying. If you're a Unified Program Agency inspector or a special inspector, then you must possess a California UST inspector certification from the Industrial Code Council. Back to you.
Okay. Good time. Okay, we're going into the home stretcher. So, completion of UST forms, and again, I put that in quotation marks because there aren't that many hard copy, well, there aren't as many hard copy forms as there used to be. Everything needs to be submitted electronically now. So if you still have businesses that are mailing things into you, I mean, other than test reports and things like that, which is still acceptable, they can't mail you permit application forms and things like that. It all needs to be electronic now. So this is a very brief summary of electronic reporting requirements submitted associated with the underground storage tank program. Could make a whole 4-hour class on this probably. But inspectors need to use the California Environmental Reporting System CERS websites, the CERS business user training portal, to familiarize themselves with navigating the CERS data entry pages. So if you're going to be helping businesses with filling out the forms, you need to be familiar with how to navigate the data entry pages that they're going to be using. And the CERS website does have a business user test portal. For that matter, they have a regulator user test portal where you can log in, and as long as you're in a test portal, you know, you can screw up pretty much anything you want without any real world repercussions. Just make sure that you are truly in the test portal, but they do a really good job of marking, identifying those pages. But don't put real world stuff in, spend a lot of time putting real world stuff in there in the test portal and thinking that you can click submit, because none of that is going to translate over to the real world. It's just kind of a play area where you can practice, take things for a test drive, but you can't, and businesses can't electronically submit something off of the test portal. But many of the UST, many CERS data elements on the screen have little help icons. I don't know if you can see it, but there's a little white question mark in a blue circle that when you click on them describe exactly what information is being requested. So if you're looking at something and say, yeah, I'm not really sure what they're asking for, well, if there's one of those, click on it and it will have a pop-up and it will tell you what information they're being asked for. And that's a hint you should also share with the businesses, because a lot of times you'll get phone calls for things that if they just clicked on that, would have answered their question. So prior to January 1st, 2013, the underground tank permit applications, applicants were required to use what were called Unified Program Consolidated Form, or UPCF documents. And there were a number of those that were associated with the underground storage tank program. So there's the business activities page. So hopefully everybody here has at least a basic familiarity with CERS and these things. But and then there's the business owner operator identification page that has the facility information about who the owner is and the operator, et cetera. Those are first two are required of any unified programs submittal. business plans or tiered permit, anything has to have those two pages. And then there's the UST specific stuff, which is the UST operating permit application facility information form, which we old timers refer to as Form A, or maybe USTA. And then there's the UST operating permit application tank information page, also known as the Form B or USTB. it's one permit application facility information per facility and one tank form per underground storage tank. If it's a compartmented tank, it's one Form B or tank information form per tank. So a three compartment tank is three regulated underground storage tanks. It's not one, it's three. And then there's the underground tank certification of installation or modification form, which is Form C or USTC. And then there's the UST monitoring plan, which was Form D or USTD. And then there were also a number of other non-UPCF compliance documents that were required to be submitted. So it was the monitoring site plan, which has content mandated, but not the format, which we talked about. UST response plan, which the state did provide as a UST Form E, but it was never adopted in Title 27 as a unified program consolidated form. So, or equivalent information, and then that's another one where the content is mandated, but not the format. So if they submit it and it's not on that standard UST response plan form, it's not a violation as long as they have the content done. There's a certification of financial responsibility for underground storage tanks containing petroleum, if applicable. Again, it's only for required for facilities that store petroleum in an underground storage tank and facilities that are not a state or federal government facility. Content mandated, but not the format. And a notification identifying the UST facilities designated UST operators. That is another one where the content is mandated, but the format is not. They can do that in any wording as long as it satisfies the requirement of notifying us who the designated operators are. Now, there was a requirement for a certification of compliance statement. The deadline for that is well past, so I'm not going to get into that, but basically they're satisfying that every time they click submit on CERS, because when they click submit on CERS, they're certifying that the information is true, accurate, and complete. They've covered that every time that they submit on CERS. So, effective January 1st, 2013, all information that was formerly on the UPCF forms and the other compliance documents is still required to be submitted to us, but it doesn't come directly to us unless we have a local portal. It goes to the CERS website, California Environmental Reporting System. So, if you're using a portal, it's really important that it be equivalent to and configured to share information with CERS. You can't require duplicate submittals. So if something's submitted on CERS, you can't say, well, also submitted on our portal, and you can't require them to submit hard copies. They submit on electronic, in an electronic format as required by the Title 27 regulations. You can't tell them, well, yeah, but we don't like CERS. We want you to submit it in hard copy. You can't make them do that. So details regarding the electronic data reporting data elements that are associated with the underground tank program are actually published in Title 27. So I've included in here the section where you can find that. It's basically called the data dictionary. And those little help bubbles that I talked about that are on the website, they pretty much follow that. But every data element is defined as far as what piece of information they're looking for. Electronic submittal requirements, or electronic submittals have to satisfy the requirements of both Title 23 and Title 27. So usually that's not a problem if they're following the instructions on the CERS website. But if they start getting creative, there might be a situation where they're not in compliance with one or the other of those sets of requirements. So, we now have new data entry screens that have replaced several of the UPCF documents. And then submittal on these screens is actually by individual data elements. That means they have to type in every individual data element. It's not anything that they can scan in and upload. So if it's one of these forms, they have to actually type in the information or in certain scenarios, they're able to do like a file upload to import the data, but we won't get into that. But every individual data element has to have information entered into it if it's applicable. So that would be the business activities, the owner operator ID page, the facility, UST facility operating permit application, remember the Form A, Form B for each tank, which is now combined with the underground storage tank monitoring plan for each tank. So now they're different screens, but they're kind of like one master document. Each tank will have a tank information and a monitoring plan that is specific to that tank. Previously in the hard copy days, we might allow one monitoring plan for multiple tanks if they all use the same equipment and methods, but now it's individual per tank. The nice thing about SERS is it has the ability for the businesses just to copy information from one tank to the other. So if everything's identical, they can just copy it and save them a huge amount of data input after they put the first one in. Or if it's substantially similar, they can copy it and then just tweak the things that are different on the additional tanks. Saves a lot of time. They don't have to type in every single thing for every single tank in that scenario. Just make sure they do a good job of putting information in the first tank and then copy it over to the other ones and tweak it as necessary. And then the UST certification of installation and modification, which is only required for UST system installation or retrofitting activities. That one is also a electronic data input form. It's not the the old UPCF hard copy form anymore. So pretty much the same documents that had to be submitted before. In addition to those, UPCF equivalents still have to be submitted, but now instead of giving us a hard copy, they need to scan it in, upload it as a PDF, like an Acrobat document, uploaded to SERS. So that would be the monitoring site plan, response plan, we already talked about those, certification of financial responsibility, if applicable, and the owner statement of designated underground tank operator compliance, which is basically the notification of who their designated operators are. So those all are required to be submitted. They can't give us hard copies. So SERS has additional links for uploading PDF copies of other documents, but there's currently no regulatory requirement for them to be submitted. So that would be the UST owner-operator written agreement that we talked about. If the permit is issued to somebody other than the operator of the tank, they have to have that agreement. There's the ability for them to upload it, but they don't have to upload it. Certainly helps us because then we can look at it before we even go out for our inspection and know it's already covered. The letter from the chief financial officer, they have a specifically titled upload ability for that. They could do that, but they can also upload that with the certification of financial responsibility and just say submitted elsewhere in SERS, or they can put kept on file at the facility. We'll get into that a little bit more detail in a minute. And then finally, miscellaneous state required documents. That would be where I see that most often is where they say on their monitoring plan, XYZ contractor or in-house environmental compliance as responsible persons. Well, that's not satisfactory. They have to actually have names and titles of individuals, but they could upload a supplemental document using this miscellaneous state required document to say, by the way, for the response plan and the monitoring plan, these are the responsible individuals' names and titles. Because they might have a lot more people than it has room for on those forms. So there's a really useful SERS FAQ. That's the which forms require uploading to SERS that I would encourage you to review, because that will answer a lot of the questions you might have as, well, does this have to be uploaded? Does that have to be uploaded? That covers it. So, from a UST standpoint, as far as the business activities page, there's really only one key data element here, and that's, does your facility own or operate an underground storage tank? Okay, it needs to be checked yes for the business that will be the UST permit holder, but if other businesses are co-located at that address, you don't want them to check yes, because that's going to screw up the count, statewide count of underground tank facilities, and it's going to screw up the count of underground storage tanks because it's going to be double reported, and it's going to cause all kinds of havoc probably with your permitting system in-house too. So if they're not the permittee they don't want to be the permit holder of the UST permit, they should check no on that and not submit any UST stuff. But if they're a permit holder, they need to submit all the UST stuff. So for the business owner operator identification page, identification is a little confusing, but identification basically means the operator name. That's the operator of the facility, not the designated UST operator, again. It's the entity, the company, or the individual that operates that facility. The owner is the name of the individual or entity that's to be permitted. Environmental contact is the name of the person who should receive compliance-related correspondence. I can't tell you how many I get that have my name in there. No, I go out and I inspect you, but I am not your environmental contact. So, you will see that. The operating permit application, the facility form. Facility type, it has a number of different boxes to check, you know, for like motor vehicle, fueling, fuel distribution, farm, etc. This is the type of facility with respect to the underground storage tank use. So for example, a trucking company that uses underground tanks to fuel their vehicles would be a motor vehicle fueling facility, but if they had all above ground tanks to fuel their trucks, and but they had an underground tank to fuel to supply an emergency generator, they would want to check other, because this is the type of business with respect to operating an underground storage tank. BOE number, boarded equalization number, this is a critical one. The state doesn't want us accepting any electronic submittal that doesn't have something in this data element. So pretty much anybody that has petroleum in their tanks, and we talked a little bit about the definition of petroleum, but certainly that'd be gas, diesel, kerosene, anything that's a biodiesel blend other than B100 pretty much. E85 is included because it's got 15% petroleum. That needs to have a Board of Equalization number, and they need to list that. That's the account number that they pay their mill tax. Every gallon of petroleum that they buy, they have to pay the state that mill tax. That goes to fund the underground storage cleanup fund. So if the facility doesn't have any petroleum tanks, the state board still wants information in that data element. So where all of the underground tanks contain only non-petroleum products, they want 4-4 followed by zeros. And if it's a state facility, because state facilities are exempt from both financial responsibility and for paying the BOE mill tax, they want 4403-2062. And for federal facilities, they want the same except with the last digit 3. So every SIRS submittal for UST facilities should have a number in here, either the actual number if they have petroleum tanks, or one of those 3 numbers if those other 3 situations apply. The type of action, confirmed or updated information, new permit, renewal permit, that needs to be filled in. So, you know, if you have a 5-year permit, they have to apply for that renewal. Even if nothing else triggers another submittal, they have to apply for it before that 5-year permit expires. If they've got a 1-year permit from you, then they have to apply for permit annually before the permit expires. So they can check renewal permit. If it's just updating information or correcting things or whatever, they would check confirmed updated information. So the permit application has to be submitted within 30 days of change of UST ownership, and a revised application has to be submitted within 30 days of a change of hazardous substance being stored. So if they switch from diesel to B20, well, in addition to the compatibility information that we talked about, they also have to submit an updated permit application. Or if they switch a, say, a mid-grade tank to regular unleaded, or a diesel tank to a gasoline tank, etc. Tank operator is the name of the individual or entity that operates the UST system. It's not asking for the name of the environmental contact, the facility contact, or the designated UST operator. That could be the same person, but most likely isn't. Tank owner type is important because that can tell you what financial responsibility mechanisms they can or can't use. If it's a private sector versus a government And if it's a state or federal facility, that will help you determine whether they're exempt from the requirements that those facilities are exempt from. Permit holder notification information is important. It can go to the facility owner, facility operator, tank owner, or the tank operator. That's who's going to actually get the permit. Three of those are clear to me, but facility owner is a very vague term, so I don't know what that means. So I encourage people not to select facility owner, because I know what facility operator is, I know what tank owner, and I know what tank operator are, but facility owner is pretty vague. And in the supervisor of division section or office, that is something that is required for government facilities. So if it's a private sector organization, they can just leave that blank. I'm sorry we're going through a lot of information. I'm not showing screenshots, but we have a very limited amount of time. And like I said, we could probably do a whole course just on this and walking people through. So also on the facility operating permit application form, it talks about the financial responsibility mechanisms. This just needs to match what's on their certification of financial responsibility, showing the same mechanisms that are listed on the certification of financial responsibility. So since the state and federal government facilities are exempt, they just need to check the box for exemption, but they do need to check one of the boxes. So even though they're exempt, they should check the box for exemption. And then you should refer to the underground storage tank FAQ, the SERS FAQ, for general reporting requirements for underground storage tank sites. There's a good breakdown on, in more detail than I've provided, on how to report that information. So for the tank information and monitoring plan, again, one page per tank. And each compartment in a compartment tank needs to be reported separately. There's a SERS FAQ on how to report tank contents that talks about how to report biodiesel blends, E85, other unusual things. I mean, your typical gas, you know, regular, mid-grade, premium, diesel, those are easy to figure out, check the box, but for some of the other things, it provides good reference on how to report those. And then as far as the monitoring plan, you should use a complete manufacturer's name and equipment model numbers. A lot of times on some paperwork, you'll see abbreviations for manufacturer's names or very shorthand versions of model numbers, but you should have the full manufacturer model number on the monitoring plan. And the monitoring plan, it's recommended that the businesses only include the things that are actually required to do by the regulations. They shouldn't throw in things like, well, we're doing automatic tank gauging if it's a double wall system. Yeah, they can do it, but I recommend you don't put it in your monitoring plan. Just put the stuff in that you're required to do, because you will be held to what you're saying you're going to do in your monitoring plan. And you know, just why set the bar any higher for yourself than you have to? Thought we were going to make it all the way through with no phones going on. So, that's what I just said. One key thing that I put in red here is businesses should not upload the obsolete UPCF form, because I've seen this a number of times where they submit the stuff on SERS and they'll just scan and upload something from, like, you know, 1997, that's the last time that they felt like filling out a form. It's the last one they could find, and they scan it and upload it. No, they can't do that. They need to actually fill out the data elements for that. So the UST certification of installation or modification, this is something you only need to worry about if it's a new install or if you're doing a repair or a retrofit that impacts the piping systems. So it's for installation of tanks and installation of piping, which would include piping secondary containment, which would be sumps, under dispenser containment, things like that. If they do monitoring equipment, they don't need to do it. Spill bucket, don't need to do it. Overflow prevention equipment, don't need to do it. But if they install tanks or piping, and that includes repairs or replacement, then they have to submit this. So I've included the regulatory sections in here with a specific regulatory requirement, but the key thing is that You only need to look for this if they've done an install or a repair. Since electronic reporting became required, they don't have to go back and install the old, upload anything for something that happened in the past. It's only if it happens from now going forward. And don't submit the old UPCF form. So you should frequently check the CERS FAQ pages, and I included the URL there, for both businesses and regulators for guidance regarding electronic reporting, because they're really, really useful, and we should all be operating from the same understanding of what's required and what's not required, so we don't want to be all over the place. So definitely use that and make sure that you're familiar with those, and refer your businesses to those if you have questions.
Okay, we're wrapping it up, I promise. So this is it. Just wanted to remind you about the local guidance letters. They're really good references. We'll give you information, the most recent one, I think it's the most recent one. The higher the number, the more recent, by the way. LG 171 talks about permanent closure of USTs with single wall components. So we've got a deadline coming up. By the end of 2025, UST systems that have single wall components need to remove or replace those or close those out by the end of 2025, because single wall components are going to be no longer allowed at that point. So this LG letter will give you information on that. These are some of the key LG letters that Greg had mentioned, some of the crucial ones that we just wanted to put up there to say, hey, use these resources, check these out, qualifications and scope of work for UST installers and service technicians, what can they do, what qualifications do they need to have, guidelines for testing spill buckets, secondary containment testing, overfill prevention, as I mentioned earlier. So great resources, definitely use it, especially LG 113 here at the bottom. So if you're new to the UST program, if you're a new inspector, don't panic. I know we just gave you a lot of information, but you have a lot of resources available to you. And if we didn't present this in a thrilling and entertaining manner, we apologize. But it is a great program, it really is, and stick with it. If you're a new inspector, give it a chance. I have a very close colleague and friend that was very resistant to learn the program, not naming names or pointing any fingers, but she has since become an excellent inspector, and I'm glad that I was able to help encourage her to really give this program a chance, because tanks are thrilling and exciting if you're interested in giving the time. So use the resources, and I hope that this presentation really helped give you some good basic beginner information and introduce you to the world of tanks. So, before I take any questions, just want to let you know we didn't get to a few other slides on UST exemptions. Greg talked in the beginning about what a tank was and what piping was, but we didn't get into the details of what a tank is not, because for the sake of time, we didn't want to. But there are six slides at the end, and this presentation is posted on the CUPA website for your reference, so please take a look and get that information. Any questions for Greg and myself? No, I guess everybody wants to get to lunch.
Yeah, they want to eat.
Okay, you're free to go then.